Thank you all once again for coming to this weekly Bible study based on the Dead Sea Scrolls. We're continuing this from last week's teaching. Last week we did a Bible study on the Testament of Reuben, the Testament of Simeon, and the Testament of Issachar. This week we're going to try to cover four testaments in our study. I have a very unique position on this, is that I believe that the testaments of the 12 patriarchs are authentic prophecy written by the actual sons of Jacob. However, there is a clarifier to that. The scholars very well understand when they are doing the studies that it has been altered from the original version significantly. What we see in the evidence is that the original version of the testaments was much longer, much fuller, it sounded much more archaic, much more Jewish in language and terminology. The current testaments that we have are much more Hellenistic and in Greek in their language and thought, but I do believe that they are a good summary and condensed version of the original. So I think we can trust the Greek version as a very good representation of the original text. It's just a drastically shorter version. So in other words, I believe the thoughts that this text has are the actual thoughts that the 12 sons of Jacob had, but the words themselves, a lot of the time, the words that are used are not the words that the patriarchs used. They're words from a much later time in date and history, and so that's an important clarifier. So I believe these texts are scripture, divinely inspired, and written in their original form by the 12 sons of Jacob, but in the current form, they were written by some scribes who decided to make a special version of their own, a reworked version of the original text. So that's an important thing, because as I will show in the first two testaments I go through, we have evidence that there were much longer versions of those two testaments. So, with that said, I will begin the testaments. I'm going to start with the Testament of Levi. That's probably the most significant one of all. So, I'm going to start, and what I did last time is basically I went through and was reading. I would read, I was not reading the entire thing. I would go through, read a good chunk of the text of the Testaments, but I would skip over certain parts which are not as important. So I'll try to do that as well, but I tend to like what these writings say so much that I just read maybe perhaps a little bit more than I need to, but it's always... it's always good to go overboard sometimes rather than not do enough, because if I go a little bit overboard in reading too much, at least you are getting the content, whereas if I don't read everything, if I get too short, then you're missing a lot of depth. So anyways, I begin now. So the Testament of Levi is one of the longest testaments of the 12 patriarchs. Most of the testaments are pretty short in the Greek version, but even in the Greek version of the Testament of Levi, it's a very long one. So I wanted to say that now. So it starts off like all the other testaments where it speaks of how he gathers his sons together and on his deathbed to give them instruction for their lives. So he begins, Levi begins, and says, "I, Levi, was born in Haran, and I came with my father to Shechem. And I was young, about 20 years of age, when with Simeon I wrought vengeance on Hamor for our sister Dinah." Stop there for a second. Already right here, we're seeing that Levi is giving us a lot of detail that we don't see in the book of Genesis. He's telling us the very place that he was born, and how old he was when the incident with Shechem happened, when he slaughtered the Shechemites. So we're already seeing that this has a lot of depth, to, adds a lot of understanding that we don't get from Genesis. Oh, and by the way, just to let you know, we can trust the Testaments are very ancient and reliable texts because the Dead Sea Scrolls, we found copies of the Testaments of the Patriarchs, very small fragments, but enough to confirm that these Testaments are legit writings that we should be taking seriously. So Levi continues and says, "And when I was feeding the flocks in Abel Mahol, the spirit of understanding of the Lord came upon me, and I saw all men corrupting their way, and that unrighteousness had built for itself walls, and lawlessness sat upon towers. And I was grieving for the race of the sons of men, and I prayed to the Lord that I might be saved." So we see that he is, like Abraham, realizing how different he is from the rest of the world, and he is reflecting on how most of the world is righteous, and he's trying to be spared from the wicked influence of the world. So he prays for protection from the enemy. Hold on one second here. Just checking to see if people are trying to log in. I see some notifications, so just making sure. Okay, we're good. So now, then we see in the Testament of Levi, Levi tells us, he says, "Then there fell upon me a sleep, and I beheld a high mountain, and I was upon it." And behold, the heavens were opened, and an angel of God said to me, "Levi, enter." And I entered from the first heaven, and I saw there a great sea hanging. I'm not going to go through all the heavens, but I just want to let you know there's some differences in the manuscripts of the heavens that he's shown. He's shown seven heavens in some manuscripts, but in others it's three manuscripts. I believe the original is seven, but most scholars believe it's three. But so it's a very interesting, you know, he sees a little bit about what each heaven, the qualities of each place have. Let's see here. Hold on. And then he asks the angel, what is he seeing? Why there are certain things the way they are? And the angel explains to him. So we're seeing that Levi had some prophecy revealed to him about the nature of the world. And here's one prophecy that the angel told him in his vision that he was having. It reads, the angel speaking to Levi, "And when thou hast ascended thither, thou shalt stand near the Lord, and shalt be his minister, and shalt declare his mysteries to men, and shalt proclaim concerning him that shall redeem Israel. And by thee and Judah shall the Lord appear among men, saving every race of men. And from the Lord's portion shall be thy life, and he shall be thy field and vineyard, and fruits, gold, and silver." So I'll stop there for a second. All throughout the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, we see constantly, again and again, the teaching that the Messiah who was to come, a priest, a special priest, and a special king, they would come from the tribe of Levi and the tribe of Judah. It would be salvation and redemption for Israel as well as the Gentiles. This is a very powerful teaching and emphasizes the message of the prophets and the New Testament, which tells us that the Gentiles have an opportunity to be saved. And that's what Genesis says too. We're told that all the nations of the world would be blessed in Abraham's seed. So we see Levi, as well as some of the other patriarchs, prophesy to us about the Savior coming from those two tribes. And I believe the evidence indicates that the Messiah, Yeshua, the son of Mary, did indeed come from those two tribes, Judah and Levi. Now, let me see here. Um, Before I continue, now I want to tell you something. Basically, we found fragments of the Testament of Levi in the Dead Sea Scrolls, as well as there was a find of the Dead Sea Scrolls about 1,000 years ago. Most people don't realize this, but the Dead Sea Scrolls were not only found in modern times. There was a find of the Dead Sea Scrolls about 1,000 years ago with a very similar story, and the same documents were found. Damascus document, Testaments of the Patriarchs, and several other writings were found. And these writings were transferred over into, they were transferred over to Cairo Geniza. A Geniza is a special place in a synagogue where the ancient writings or manuscripts, which are to be stored in a special, keeping them safe, they're stored in a room in a synagogue, and that's called a Geniza. And so Cairo is in Egypt, and so there's a Cairo Geniza, and there scholars found a bunch of ancient writings, some of them found elsewhere only in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And so we have testaments of the Testament of Levi in Aramaic fragments that was found there, and also in the Dead Sea Scrolls. But in those fragments, we found a much longer version of the Testament of Levi. And the Greek, as I said, the Testament of Levi is in Greek. And most manuscripts have the shorter text throughout the entire thing. But there is one Greek manuscript which is very special, because in two places, a scribe wrote in a Greek translation of the longer version, the Aramaic version, of Testament of Levi. And so I'm going to read one right now. Basically, we saw at the very beginning of the Testament of Levi, in the Greek one that I read, there was a tiny little thing that just said, "And I was grieving for the race of the sons of men, and I prayed to the Lord that I might be saved." So all it says is, "I prayed that I might be saved." But it doesn't tell us the content of his prayer. What were the words he used? Because we find in Scripture there's a long, lengthy prayers a lot of times that people make. And so we just have to, if we just had the Greek text, we would just assume, okay, that's all he, you know, we don't know what he prayed. We just know that he prayed something for his salvation. But there was actually found his prayer in the complete text. So here's what his prayer says in the full version. So it was found in Aramaic fragments in the Dead Sea Scrolls, in the Cairo Geniza, as well as the Greek translation. The Greek translation of the longer text that a scribe added in one manuscript. So here's what it says. "Then I washed my clothes and purified them in pure water, and I washed completely in running water, and I made all my paths straight. Then I raised my eyes and my face to heaven, and I opened my mouth and spoke, and I spread out the fingers of my hands and my hands to the truth before the sanctuary. And I prayed and I said, O Lord, you know all hearts, and you alone understand all thoughts of insights. And now my children are with me, and give me all the ways of truth. Put far from me, O Lord, the unrighteous spirit and wicked thought, and turn sexual immorality and insolence away from me. Let there be revealed to me, Master, the Holy Spirit, and give me counsel and wisdom and knowledge and power to do the things pleasing to you, and to find grace before you, and to praise your words with me, O Lord. And let no Satan dominate me to make me stray from your path, and have mercy on me, and bring me near to be your slave and to minister to you well. Let your peace be a wall around me, and let the shade of your power shelter me from all harm. Deliver, therefore, indeed, and obliterate lawlessness from under heaven, and terminate lawlessness from the face of the earth. Purify my heart, Master, from all impurity, and may I myself be raised up to you, and do not turn your face away from the son of your servant Jacob. You, O Lord, blessed Abraham my father and Sarah my mother, and you promised to give them a righteous seed blessed forever. And listen, and let the voice of your servant Levi be near to you, and make me and my sons participate in your words, so as to accomplish true judgment to all the eternal generations, and do not withdraw the son of your servant from your face for all the days of eternity. And I became silent while still praying. And then there's sometimes there's some portions of the text missing in the fragment, and so there's a little bit missing, and it says, then I set out in to my father Jacob, and when from Abel Mayim, then I lay down, and I myself stayed. Then I was shown a vision, in a vision of visions, and I saw the heavens under me, high until it clung to the heavens. To me, the gates of heaven, and a single angel, and then it breaks off there. But so basically, what you just saw is, that's like so much longer than what the Greek text says. All we have in the Greek text is, for that passage, it says, and when I was feeding the flocks in Abel Mol, the spirit of understanding of the Lord came upon me, and I saw all men corrupting their way, and that unrighteousness had built for itself walls, and lawlessness sat upon towers. And I was grieving for the race of the sons of men, and I prayed to the Lord that I might be saved. And then it goes on into the vision of the heavens. But so you see, that huge prayer got shortened into, and then I prayed. Wow, that's amazing how radically altered this text is. But it just shows us that that's a very long prayer, so you could understand why some scribes who are copying it, they shortened it for the sake of readers who don't have long attention spans. Many times people don't think prayers are that important. So they just say, well, you know, we'll just say that he prayed for this, and we won't give much detail, but that should be sufficient for someone to get the basic gist of the narrative. And that's what happened. All throughout the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, whoever was responsible for making that shorter version that survives in the Greek text, they basically decided, I'm going to go throughout the entire thing, and I'm going to make it super short so that people can have the basic essence of it. And actually, even though that's very upsetting that they did that, that may be the very thing that enabled us to have copies of the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. If they didn't create that shorter version, perhaps no copies of this would ever have been preserved. But because it was so short, people were like, okay, we can preserve this. It's not too hard to preserve this. It's pretty short. But imagine a huge book. They would be very hesitant to preserve the information because it would just take so long. You had to copy it out by hand. So I'm going to also be, in a little while, I'm going to be reading some other fragments of the original Testament of Levi that were found in Aramaic, but not at the moment. I will be getting back to that. So I'm going to continue with the Greek text here. And so we see the angels talking to Levi, and he says, hear therefore regarding the heavens widen have been, I think that's a scanning error, it should probably which have been shown to thee. The lowest is for this cause gloomy unto thee, in that it beholds all the unrighteous deeds of men. And it has fire, snow, and ice made ready for the day of judgment in the righteous judgment of God. For in it are all the spirits of the retributions for vengeance on men. And in the next heaven it talks about Belial and the hosts of the angels and the armies, the heavenly armies and the holy ones being there. It talks about in the highest heavens is where the great glory dwells above all holiness. The great glory being the most high, I think. And all the sanctuary of the highest heavens. And it talks about the archangels, where they reside in the heavens, and the different functions of some of what the angels are doing. The praying. It talks about the Apostle Paul in his letters mentions different types of angels. Like he mentions thrones, dominions, principalities. What we see here in Testament of Levi, he talks about, in the heaven next to this are thrones and dominions, in which always they offer praise to God. So we're seeing, where did Paul get some of this information? He very likely, a lot of scholars think that he got it from some of these ancient Jewish writings. which use this terminology. So, and then it says, when therefore the Lord looketh upon us, all of us are shaken, yea, the heavens and the earth and the abysses are shaken at the presence of his majesty. But the sons of men, having no perception of these things, sin and provoke the Most High. We see this very true. The ignorance of the world, they don't look at the signs of nature, realizing they're being judged. But they ignore the signs, and they continue mocking God and cursing him and sinning against him until eventually they end up being cursed and condemned. They will very likely die of major diseases and all kinds of punishment that they receive as a result of their rebellion. But it's all based on their ignorance. If they only took notice to the signs that the Most High gives us. And it goes on, talks about a judgment that's to come, that telling us that he's going to bring judgment on the world. The angel's telling us. Now, some scholars think this might be a Christian edition, but I don't believe it is. It's a prophecy of the future. And it says, now therefore know that the Lord shall execute judgment upon the sons of men, because when the rocks are being rent, and the sun quenched, and the waters dried up, and the fire cowering, and all creation troubled, and the invisible spirits melting away, and Hades, or Sheol, we know Sheol and Hades are the same thing, just Hades is the translation. Sheol take the spoils through the visitations of the Most High. Men will be unbelieving and persist in their iniquity. On this account, with punishment, shall they be judged. Basically, if this is a prophecy of the Messiah, it's saying that the Most High will visit Sheol through the Messiah. He's sending the Messiah on his behalf as his representative. And it will take spoils. Which seems to refer to the Messiah's activity of removing some of the saints or the righteous and transferring them over to the Garden of Eden or to paradise. Now let's see here. So then the angel continues and says, therefore the Most High hath heard thy prayer to separate thee from iniquity, and that thou shouldst become to him a son, and a servant, and a minister of his presence. The light of knowledge shall light up in Jacob, and as the sun shalt thou be to all the seed of Israel. And there shall be given to thee a blessing, and to all thy seed, until the Lord shall visit all the Gentiles in his tender mercies forever. So that's basically a prophecy. The angel said, now that I've told you about all the heavens, I'm going to tell you about the prayer that you gave, that wonderful prayer. He, the Most High, has heard your prayer, he's answering your prayer, and he's choosing you to be a special chosen one for him. You're going to be a high priest, your seed is going to be the Levites, and you're going to, what does it say? It says, given to thee a blessing unto all thy seed until the Lord shall visit all the Gentiles in his tender mercies. And that's what happened. The Messiah came, he visited, and the Gentiles received the faith, at least in the beginning. We see now the Gentiles have kind of abandoned the faith. But so in that time, the Gentiles were receptive to the message. And then we found out the Levitical priesthood was activated, not abolished or done away with, but it was made unable to be done because the temple was destroyed, and now the Levite priests haven't done sacrifices in 2,000 years about. So we see this prophecy is fulfilled here. Now let's see here. Levi is shown the holy temple and the throne of glory of the Most High. And the angel says, Levi, I have given thee the blessings of the priesthood until I come and sojourn in the midst of Israel. Then the angel brought me down to the earth and gave me a shield and a sword and said to me, execute vengeance on Shechem because of Dinah, thy sister, and I will be with thee because the Lord hath sent me. And I destroyed at that time the sons of Hamor, as it is written in the heavenly tablets. So I'll stop there for a second. Basically, Testament of Levi takes the position that Levi was a righteous man and he got the priesthood because of his slaughtering of the Shechemites. Now, when we read the book of Genesis, it paints a different picture. It seems to paint a different picture of as if Levi did a bad thing and that Levi was in the wrong for it. But according to the Testament of Levi and according to the book of Jubilees, we have two witnesses that tell us that Levi was righteous for doing that. He was actually commanded by an angel of God to execute these people. Why did he execute the Shechemites? We will see a little bit later. Levi explains why he executed the Shechemites. It's because they were so wicked people. For a second, I just want to say, Sean, are you having some connection issues? I see you signing in and out a couple times. Okay, hopefully it won't happen too much, but if it keeps doing that, keep trying to come in, hopefully it'll work. But so we're talking now with the Shechemites, when Levi and Simeon slaughtered them, and we were told that an angel commanded Levi to do this. So how can an angel of God command you to do this, and then you to be in the wrong for doing it? It doesn't make sense. So according to Levi, we realize that Jacob was... did not understand. Jacob did not realize that an angel had commanded this. So in ignorance, Jacob opposed what was being done, not realizing that this was the will of God. So Levi says he did what the angel told him, and it was written in the heavenly tablets. Jubilee says that the same thing, that what Levi did was written in the heavenly tablets. They were written for righteousness. Let me see the exact thing that Jubilee says. I want to get it right here so you'll see the correspondence here. It says, Simeon and Levi came unexpectedly to Shechem and executed judgment on all the men of Shechem. I'll skip that verse. Let's see. I was pretty sure if you read the whole thing, you'll see it says the same thing, but I can't find it right now and I don't want to waste time looking for it. But so Jubilees matches and corresponds with Levi's account, and it says that what he did was written in the tablets as a righteousness on their behalf. So, and then Levi speaks to this angel and he says, I pray thee, O Lord, or Master, tell me thy name, that I may call upon thee in a day of tribulation. Sort of like when Jacob, when wrestling with this being, he said, tell me your name. Because knowing someone's name knows who they are, their character, their essence, what their mission in life is. And so Levi wanted to know this guy's name, this angelic being's name, because he wanted to call upon him if he ever needed his help. And the angel said, I am the angel who intercedeth for the nation of Israel, that they may not be smitten utterly, for every evil spirit attacketh it. And after these things I awaked and blessed the Most High and the angel who intercedeth for the nation of Israel and for all the righteous. And Levi gives more detail about this experience that happened. He says, when I was going to my father, I found a brazen shield, and wherefore also the name of the mountain is Aspis, which is near Gibal to the south of Abilah. And I kept these words in my heart. He kept the words of the angel in his heart. And after this, I counseled my father and Reuben my brother to bid the sons of Hamor not to be circumcised, for I was jealous because of the abomination which they had wrought on my sister. So remember, in the account of Genesis, it speaks of how Simeon tricked them in saying, circumcise yourselves and we'll be at peace with you. Jacob also had said, we cannot be at peace with you unless you are circumcised. And probably Jacob was open to the idea of being at peace with them. He wanted to be at peace, like with Esau. Remember, Esau wanted to kill Jacob. Well, he wanted to pacify Esau so they could be at peace with each other. Same thing here. A horrible sin had happened, but he wants to prevent bloodshed. He wants to prevent war. He says, if you circumcise yourselves, we will be in unity with you. Levi, however, because he had just been told by the angel, you have to execute these people, Levi felt it was a sin for these people to be circumcised, only to be slaughtered right after, because it's desecrating the holy sign of circumcision. It's circumcision is supposed to be done as a sign of entering the covenant. But the people who are about to be killed cannot enter the covenant. So Levi was warning Jacob and his brother, don't let this happen. Reuben. He was warning Reuben because Reuben was the firstborn. So he said, don't let this happen. But as we find out, Simeon was the one who encouraged it to happen. So Levi goes on and says, and I slew Shechem first, and Simeon slew Hamor. And after this, my brothers came and smote that city with the edge of the sword. So we see it was instigated by Levi and Simeon, but the brothers went along with it too. They were more than happy to assist them in killing the people. And so then Levi says, and my father heard these things and was wroth, and he was grieved in that they had received the circumcision and after that had been put to death. And in his blessings, he looked amiss upon us. When he said upon us, in his blessings, he looked amiss upon us, he's talking about his blessings for Levi and his blessings for Simeon. If you look up in Genesis, his blessings, they're a little bit harsh for Levi and Simeon. Basically, he says, you guys are full of wrath and bloodshed. And he doesn't have as nice things to say. However, it is a blessing that he's giving. So it's not, he's not cursing his sons. He's blessing them. But in his blessings, you give someone a compliment, but in that compliment, it's kind of like an implied insult. It's like a backhanded compliment, I think is what it's called. So that's kind of what Jacob was almost doing. He was saying he was blessing his two sons, Simeon and Levi, but also kind of criticizing them for what they did. Levi says, for we sinned because we had done this thing against his will, and he was sick on that day. But I saw that the sentence of God was for evil upon Shechem. For they sought to do to Sarah and Rebekah as they had done to Dinah our sister, but the Lord prevented them. And they persecuted Abraham our father when he was a stranger, and they vexed his flocks when they were big with young, and Eblion, who was born in his house, they most shamefully handled. And thus they did to all strangers, taking away their wives by force, and they banished them. But the wrath of the Lord came upon them to the uttermost. So basically, it seems a little strange here. First, Levi is saying, we sinned because we had done this thing. But then he's saying, but the sentence of God commanded me to do this, and we were justified in doing this. How do you reconcile that? There's two ways to reconcile it. One is, as I said, this is a shortened version of the original. So perhaps the person who shortened it inaccurately rendered it as sinned, and he shouldn't have said sin. But it's also the case that the word for sin in Greek and Hebrew actually means to miss the mark. And that often doesn't mean necessarily a sin, but it can mean not being in alignment with a perfection or accuracy. And so Jacob had a will, a commandment, and Levi was involved in something that made it so that Jacob's will did not happen. So you can sin against God's will, you can sin against the government's will, and you can sin against your parents' will. But what is the most important concern is sinning against God's will. So in other words, if the government tells you, you cannot pray for 30 days. We saw that in the book of Daniel. Remember that? In Daniel, you cannot pray for 30 days. well, if you pray during those 30 days, you sinned against the government's will. But you didn't sin against God's will. So there's different hierarchies here. What is truly sin? You might sin against someone's will, but their will might not necessarily be the gauge of truth. So Levi, he's just telling us that we had sinned against his will. He's not saying he sinned against God's will, and that's really what matters, because that's what righteousness is. It's his ultimate will. So that's kind of how I interpret it, and this shows us, because Levi, I believe this was written by Levi, telling us in his own words that he was justified. And then Levi also justifies himself to his father and says, "And I said to my father Jacob, by thee will the Lord destroy the Canaanites, and will give their land to thee and to thy seed after thee. For from this day forward shall Shechem be called a city of imbeciles, for as a man mocketh a fool, so did we mock them, because they also had wrought folly in Israel by defiling my sister. And we departed and came to Bethel." So I'll stop there for a second. And now, just so you know, that's a very detailed and lengthy account of the Shechemites. However, in the original version of the Testament of Levi, it was even longer. Unfortunately, most of that longer version is missing. There's only small fragments. So I'm only going to read a couple of those fragments, but you'll see by the tiny little fragments that we are missing. We are missing a longer version. So in the these weren't found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but these were found in the Cairo Geniza, the Aramaic fragments there. So it reads in one fragment, or it reads in part of this, it says, hold on one second, okay? Okay, sorry guys. Okay. So, it says, again, there's fragments missing, so I'm going to have to, I'll just kind of give a pause. When you hear me pause, that's an indication that there's something missing there, okay? "She has defiled the sons that all, to do according to the law of all, Jacob my father and Reuben my brother. And we said to them, they wish for our daughter, and that we all become brothers and companions. Circumcise the foreskin of your flesh, and you will appear like us, and you will be sealed like us with circumcision of righteousness, and we will be to you. Know that they have been made impure by their sons, them, and they will not leave them alone until all of them perish. Then Hamor, and they spoke with words of the men of their city, them to circumcise and to do it, to be sons-in-law to them and to lead them astray, foreskin of their flesh. And I reckoned, and I, in secret, and let us kill all the sons of Shechem, for on this day God has given, and at this time God has consigned all of them into our hand to kill them and to make of truth. Then answered my brother, very zealous from, get up, come in your wisdom, and take my sword in yours, and we will accomplish judgment, Shechem and God. My brothers in every time, who were in Shechem, my brothers, and he revealed this, in Shechem and whatever, doers of violence. And Judah told them that I and Simeon my brother went to join Reuben our brother, who was east of Asher, and Judah leapt forward to leave the sheep." So anyways, that's all we have of the fragments here, but that tells us there was a much longer account of the Shechemites, much greater detail that we are missing now. So it's just amazing how the Testament of Levi, the original version, was so much longer. And it just shows us how the scribes can alter the text of Scripture so much. Not only has this happened in the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, but they did this with the book of Deuteronomy. It's very sad to say this, but the law of Moses itself has been radically altered in the same way. And other books in the Old Testament, too. Major differences. The book of Acts, I believe the original book of Acts was a good size longer. Not like this, though, but there was some additional, like, a good chunk longer. But this is, the Testament is much longer. And so on a similar level, the Temple Scroll is much longer than the than our copies of Deuteronomy. And so we see that it's a parallel here. So it happened with other books of Scripture, very unfortunately. It just is a lesson for us that we can learn textual criticism and understand how the scribes work in their process. So I'll continue now. Levi says, "And there again I saw a vision even as the former, after we had spent there 70 days. Hold on. Are you asking, when the scribes altered it, was it deception or ease of copying or a little both? I don't think they were trying to deceive people by altering the text. They had a purpose, a reason. I'll give an example. The book of Job. In the Septuagint version, it's much shorter. Huge passages are missing sometimes. When you realize what's removed, most of the time, what's removed is parallelisms. So you know how in the Bible, it'll say one thing, and then in the second line, it'll say something almost identical to the first thing, but in different words? The Book of Job version of the Septuagint, they're like, that's kind of unnecessary. We just will keep the one and remove the repetition of the parallel. They did that so many times. And then they also removed some controversial content. Not that they believe that it's not scripture, but they removed it because they felt it was not applicable to the reading audience, or that it was too hard for them to understand, or that it could confuse them and make them think something evil. They didn't want that. So they made a censored version for the sake of protecting people in their understanding. They wanted to protect them, or to give something that was more beneficial to them. What they thought was more beneficial. So I don't think they were ever trying to intentionally deceive people about what the real truth was. I don't think that's how the scribes work, because the scribes believe these are books of scripture. So they're not trying to deceive people. But they unknowingly deceive people when they did this stuff. But so Levi describes to us a vision that he has, and he talks about, "I saw seven men in white raiment saying unto me, Arise, put on the robe of the priesthood, and the crown of righteousness, and the breastplate of understanding, and the garment of truth, and the plaid of faith, and the turban of the head, and the ephod of prophecy." Now, that's not exactly the same thing as what Paul says, but it's kind of an interesting parallel about how, you know, Paul's talking about putting on the armor of God. This isn't the armor, but it's the priestly garments. But each garment is reflecting a symbolic value: the crown of righteousness, the breastplate of understanding, the garment of truth, the plaid of faith, and the turban of the head, and the ephod of prophecy. "And they severally carried and put on me, and said unto me, From henceforth become a priest of the Lord, thou and thy seed forever. And the first," he's talking about the first man that he saw in white, "the first anointed me with holy oil, and gave to me a staff of judgment. The second washed me with pure water, and fed me with bread and wine, the most holy things, and clad me with a holy and glorious robe. The third clothed me with a linen vestment, like an ephod. The fourth put round me a girdle like unto purple. The fifth gave me a branch of rich olive. The sixth placed a crown on my head. The seventh placed on my head a diadem of priesthood, and filled my hands with incense, that I might serve as priest to the Lord God. And they said to me, Levi, thy seed shall be divided into three offices, for a sign of the glory of the Lord who is to come. And the first portion shall be great, yea, greater than it shall none be. The second shall be in the priesthood, And the third shall be called by a new name, because a king shall arise in Judah and shall establish a new priesthood after the fashion of the Gentiles to all the Gentiles. And his presence is beloved as a prophet of the Most High, of the seed of Abraham our father. Therefore, every desirable thing in Israel shall be for thee and for thy seed. And ye shall eat everything fair to look upon, and the table of the Lord shall thy seed apportion. And some of them shall be high priests and judges and scribes, for by their mouth shall the holy place be guarded. So that was his vision. Now, to go through it a little bit, so he had the seven men, and each of them gave him a special clothing of the priesthood, or special item to signify that he was being ordained as a high priest. So this is clear evidence that the Levitical priesthood did not originate after the golden calf, as some people try to claim. There's Matthew Moshe, I think is his name. I strongly disagree with his teachings about this. He basically teaches that most of the law of Moses was added as a punishment and a negative thing after the golden calf incident, and that it was never God's intention to have a temple or a Levitical priesthood or any of that. That only came as a punishment for us. But the Testament of Levi, all the Testaments in general, the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, and Book of Jubilees, these clearly prove to us that Levi was chosen as a high priest, and the high priesthood was always there for Levi ever since Levi's day. It didn't come in Moses' time. So it's an amazing revelation that we don't get in our copies of the Bible. And then what we see is that we were told that there was three offices. When he said the first portion shall be great, it's talking about the Levites. There'll be so many Levites, so it'll be a great portion. The second shall be in the priesthood. So there's Levites, but then there's the priests of the Levites. So that's the Aaron line, the line of Aaron, because only sons of Aaron could be priests. Aarons were sons of Levi, but not all sons of Levi could be priests. Once it came to Moses' day, Moses limited it to only Aaron's line for the priesthood. So that's a prophecy here that Levi's telling us. And then he says there's going to be a third portion called by a new name. He's basically saying the Messiah is from the tribe of Levi, but he will arise in Judah and shall establish a new priesthood for the benefit of the Gentiles. Because the first priesthood was the Levitical, focused primarily on the Israelites, but the second priesthood that's mentioned in the New Testament has a wider application. You don't have to be of Israelite blood to benefit from it. You can be of any blood, and you repent, you come under the shadow of the priesthood of the Messiah. That's what Levi's prophecy speaks of. And it says that his presence is beloved, that's the Messiah, as a prophet of the Most High, of the seed of Abraham our father. So remember, Paul interprets the seed of Abraham as a prophecy of Messiah. Well, here we're seeing that Levi is saying the Messiah, the priest to come, he's going to be a prophet of the Most High, and he's going to be of the seed of Abraham our father. So it's connecting that with the seed. And then let me see here. He says, some of them shall be high priests and judges and scribes. And that's what the law tells us. That's why the Levites, they're supposed to be our judges and scribes. And so then Levi, he says, and when I awoke, I understood that this was like the first dream. And I hid this also in my heart and told it not to any man upon the earth. Now, and then it goes into a new topic. Before I go to that topic, I just want to say read one other thing in the fragment here. The original version of the Testament of Levi found in fragments, partially in the Dead Sea Scrolls and Cairo Yenizah. It says, peace and everything desirable of the first fruits of the entire earth for food, and to the kingdom of the sword belong fighting and war and butchery and exertion and shrieking and killing and famine. At times it shall eat, and at times it shall go hungry. At times it shall labor, and at times it shall rest. At times it shall sleep, and at times the sleep of the eye shall flee. Now see for yourself how we have increased you more than all, and how we have given you the greatness of eternal peace. And there seven glided away from me, and I woke up from my sleep. Then I said, this was a vision. And so I was astonished that there should be to me any vision, and I concealed this also in my heart, and I did not reveal it to anyone. So we're seeing right there, that's the same thing that we just read, but a much longer version. In what I read to you first, there was no mention of war, famine, all this like negative stuff. Seems to me the scribe who made the shorter version, he kept the good prophecy parts and then kind of removed that negative stuff about all the war and everything. Too bloody for people. That's kind of what it seems. And then, as I said, sometimes the words are very repetitive, so scribes would shorten it because it's the same thing. So, like, in this, it says, and I hid this also in my heart and told it not to any man upon the earth. And that's the Greek. In the interestingly enough, the Aramaic fragment actually almost is word for word in that sentence. It says, and I concealed this also in my heart, and I did not reveal it to anyone. So it's clearly the same thing. It mentioned in this Aramaic fragment, the fragments, the seven. And we remember here, the seven men clothed in white. So it's a fuller version. It's very opening of the mind. So now, this next thing is really crazy. This is the most radical difference in the Greek version from the original text. It's a little long, but you'll really like it. Okay? So bear with me on this. And at the rate I'm doing this teaching, it seems to me that I will definitely get the two of the testaments done. I might be able to do a third, but I highly doubt I'll be able to do the four testaments that I was originally planning to do. So, but you know what? We don't want to rush through it. So, Levi says, immediately after where he said, I hid this and told it not to anyone, immediately after he says, and after 2 days, I and Judah went up with our father Jacob to Isaac, our father's father. And my father's father blessed me according to all the words of the visions which I had seen, and he would not come with us to Bethel. And when we came to Bethel, my father Jacob saw a vision concerning me, that I should be their priest unto God. And he rose up early in the morning, and paid tithes of all to the Lord through me. And so we came to Hebron to dwell there. And Isaac called me continually to put me in remembrance of the law of the Lord, even as the angel of the Lord showed unto me. And he taught me the law of the priesthood, of sacrifices, whole burnt offerings, first fruits, freewill offerings, peace offerings. And each day he was instructing me, and was busied on my behalf before the Lord, and said to me, beware of the spirit of fornication, for this shall continue, and shall by thy seed pollute the holy place. Take therefore to thyself a wife without blemish or pollution, while yet thou art young, and not of the race of strange nations. And before entering into the holy place, bathe, and when thou offerest the sacrifice, wash. And again, when thou finishest the sacrifice, wash. Of 12 trees, having leaves, offer to the Lord, as Abraham taught me also. And of every clean beast and bird, offer a sacrifice to the Lord. And of all thy first fruits and of wine, offer the first as a sacrifice to the Lord God. And every sacrifice thou shalt salt with salt. Now, therefore, observe whatsoever I command you, children, for whatsoever things I have heard from my fathers, I have declared unto you. I'll stop there because the next part isn't found in the Aramaic fragments. But so now, okay, so that was not that long, okay? That was from the Greek text. And that tells us that Isaac taught Levi the priesthood, the laws of the priesthood, of what a high priest requires, all the laws of how to sacrifice properly, because the priesthood and their laws, they didn't originate with Levi. The Levitical priesthood originated with Levi, but the law of priesthood originated much longer before. Remember, Abel was doing sacrifices, and Noah was a priest, Abraham, and Isaac, we see. And Jacob was doing some sacrifices too. But since Isaac was teaching Jacob, it seems to indicate, Isaac was teaching Levi, so it seems that Jacob was not appointed as a high priest. Only Isaac was. Jacob might have been a lesser priest. For some reason, it had not transferred to Jacob. That's my how I interpret it anyway, because otherwise I would think that Jacob would be the one teaching, but in this case, Isaac is. And so now, the Aramaic fragments of this is, wow, like this, when I read this to you, you're going to see that's a huge difference. We're missing so much, but you can see why they might shorten it, especially if it's for a Christian audience, because remember, the Christian audience doesn't care about all this stuff. And even if it wasn't a Christian audience, the Jews, for instance, if they were responsible for the shorter version, a lot of the stuff they might not have thought was relevant to them either. So just like the Temple Scroll was shortened to our copies of Deuteronomy, the original version of the Testament of Levi in this passage was shortened so that it gave you a brief overview of the priesthood laws, but not the super in-depth thing that the original had. So here's the super in-depth original version. It was found in that, remember, that one manuscript of Greek had a translation of two passages, I said, from the fuller text of Aramaic, and that one of those passages was the prayer, and the other one was this law of the priesthood that was translated into Greek. There was also Aramaic fragments found in Cairo Geniza and the Dead Sea Scrolls. So we have a lot of witnesses confirming that this much longer version was the original. So it says, immediately after, where, remember, I was reading, I said, in the Aramaic text, and I concealed this also in my heart, and I did not reveal it to anyone. Immediately after that, it says in the fragments, and we went into my father Isaac, and he also thus blessed me. Then when Jacob my father was tithing everything that he had, according to his vow, I was first at the head of the priesthood, and to me, of all his sons, he gave the sacrificial gift of the tithe to God. And he clothed me with the vestment of the priesthood, and ordained me, and I became a priest to the God of eternity. And I offered all his offerings, and I blessed my father in his lifetime, and I blessed my brothers. Then all of them blessed me, and also father blessed me, and I finished offering his offerings at Bethel. And we went from Bethel, and we camped at the fortress of Abraham our father with Isaac our father. And Isaac our father saw all of us, and he blessed us, and he rejoiced. And when he knew that I was a priest of God Most High, Lord of Heaven, he began to instruct me and teach me the law of the priesthood. And he said to me, Levi, guard yourself, my son, from all impurity and from all sin. Your law is greater than all flesh. And now, my son, I will show you the true law, and I will not conceal any matter from you to teach you the law of the priesthood. First, guard yourself, my son, from all wantonness and impurity and from all sexual immorality. And as for you, take for yourself a wife from my clan, and do not desecrate your seed with prostitutes. Behold, you are a holy seed, and your seed is holy, just like the holy place, since you are called a holy priest for all the seed of Abraham. You are near to God and near to all his holy ones. Now be worthy in your flesh from all impurity of every man. And when you stand to enter the house of God, bathe in water and then put on the priestly vestment. And when you are clothed, wash your hands and your feet once again before you approach the altar at all. And when you take to offer all that is proper to take to the altar, wash your hands and your feet once again and make the offering, splitting logs and examining them first for worms. And then lift them up, for like so did I see Abraham my father taking pains. From all 12 kinds of wood, he said to me that it is proper to take of them to the altar, the scent of whose smoke rises sweetly. And these are their names: cedar, juniper, almond, fir, acacia, pine, cypress, fig, and oleaster, laurel, myrtle, and asphaleathos. That's a Greek rendering. That was the Greek translation. These are the ones that he said to me, it is fitting to lift up of them beneath the holocaust on the altar. And when you lift up any of these woods unto the altar, and the fire begins to kindle them, and behold, then you shall begin to sprinkle the blood on the sides of the altar. And again, Wash your hands and your feet of the blood, and begin to lift up the salted limbs. And lift up the head first, and cover it with abdominal fat. And there should not be seen on it the blood of the freewill offering of the ox. And after it, its neck. And after its neck, its forelegs. And after its forelegs, the breast with the ribs. And after this, the thighs with the spinal column of the loins. And after the thighs, the back legs washed with the entrails. And all of them salted with salt, such as is proper for them, as much as they require. And after this, fine meal mixed with oil. And after it all, libate wine, and burn incense over them. And thus let your actions be in order, in all your offerings acceptable, as a soothing odor before God Most High. And everything that you do, do it in order, do it by measure, and by weight. You shall not add anything that is not proper, and you shall not leave out of reckoning what is proper. Of the wood proper for offering, for all that ascends the altar, for the mature bull, a talent of wood for it by weight. And if the fat is offered by itself, 6 minas. And if it is a second bull that is offered, 50 minas. And with reference to its fat only, 5 minas. And for an unblemished calf, 40 minas. And if a ram or sheep or a he-goat of goats is what is being offered, for this, 30 minas. And for the fat, 3 minas. And if a lamb of sheep or a kid of goats, 20 minas. And for the fat, 2 minas. And if a year-old unblemished lamb or kid of goats, 15 minas, and for the fat, 1 mina and a half. And produce salt for the large bull, to salt its meat, and offer on the altar. A say is fitting for the bull, and in a case in which there is a superabundance of salt, salt the skin with it. I'll stop here for a second. You can see why a scribe might have said, oh, this is so lengthy, let's just shorten this. So I'll continue. And for the second bull, 5/6 of a say, and of the calf, 2/3 of a say, and for the ram, 1/2 of a say, and the same for the he-goat, and for the lamb and the kid, 1/3 of a say, and fine wheat and flour fitting for them, for the mature bull, and the second bull, and the calf, a say of fine wheat and flour, and for the ram and the he-goat, 2 parts of a say, and for the lamb and the kid of goats, 1/3 part of a say, and the oil, and 1/4 of a say for the bull, mixed with this fine wheat and flour, and for the ram, 1/6 of a say, and for the lamb, 1/8 of a say, and of a lamb also wine according to the measure of the oil for the bull and the ram, and the kid libate as a drink offering. 6 shekels of frankincense for the bull, and 1/2 that much for the ram, and 1/3 of it for the kid, and all the mixed fine wheat and flour which you shall offer alone, not on fat, there shall be poured out on it a weight of frankincense of 2 shekels. 1/3 of a say is 1/3 of an ephah, and 2/3 of a bath, and the weight of a mina is 50 of shekels, and 1/4 of a shekel is the weight of 4 thermoi. Let the shekel be about 16 thermoi, and 1 weight. And now, my child, hear my words, and hearken to my commands, and do not let these words withdraw from your heart in all your days, for you are a holy priest of the Lord, and all your seed shall be priests. And so command your sons that they should do according to this law as I have shown you. For so Father Abraham commanded me to do, and to command my sons. And now, child, I rejoice that you have been chosen for holy priesthood, and to offer sacrifice to the Lord Most High, as is fitting to do according to this that has been commanded. When you undertake to carry out a sacrifice of any flesh before the Lord, accept thus according to the reckoning of the wood, as I command you, and the salt, and the fine wheat and flour, and the wine and the frankincense, accept also from their hands concerning all flocks. And every hour wash hands and feet when you go to the altar. And when you go out of the sanctuary, do not let any of the blood touch your robe. Do not lay hold of it on the same day. And wash hands and feet completely of all flesh, and let there not be seen on you any blood or any life, for the blood is life in the flesh. And if in the house you eat some meat for yourself, cover its blood with earth first, before you eat any of the meat, and do not any longer be eating in proximity to the blood. For thus did my father Abraham command me, because he found it so in the writing of the book of Noah concerning the blood. And now as to you, beloved child, I say you are beloved to your father, and a holy one of the Lord Most High. And you shall be beloved over all your brothers. By your seed shall one be blessed on the earth, and your seed shall be preserved for all the ages in the book of remembrance of life, and your name and the name of your seed shall not be erased for the ages. And now, child Levi, blessed shall your seed be on earth for the generations of the ages. So that was very long. But I wanted to read that all just to show you how radically shortened the Greek version has. So isn't that crazy? All those laws for the sacrifices were reduced to one sentence in Greek, which said, "And he taught me the law of the priesthood of sacrifices, whole burnt offerings, first fruits, free will offerings, peace offerings." That's it for all the parts about the sacrifices. That's crazy. Super shortened in the Greek text. But basically, the reason they shortened it was because they knew that most of the people would not want to read that because it doesn't apply to them. It's a huge, lengthy stuff about the priesthood, and we can't even do the priesthood anymore. So why would people want to read this? Because they would feel it was too dull to read, and it would be very long to copy, too. It would be very tedious for a scribe to write all that. They're like, oh, this is so long to write this. So you can see why they would shorten it. But it just shows us how easy it is and how often it did happen for the scriptures to be altered significantly. So, just like this, I believe, happened with Deuteronomy, how the Temple Scroll was the original really long version, and then Deuteronomy, the copies we have in all our Bibles, are a super shortened version of the full original text of the Book of the Law. So we're really, if you look at my teachings on the Temple Scroll, you will see the evidence of what I say is true, and that the original Book of the Law, we're missing so much in our copies of Deuteronomy. It's not even funny. So it makes you weep when you realize this, but it also makes you joyful when you realize, wow, this is we are seeing a picture of what the original text was, and it really is a blessing to see. We're very close. The more we find in the Dead Sea Scrolls, the closer we get to the original text. It's a real blessing what we're seeing. And what was really cool is we saw Levi refer to the book of Noah, and that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. A fragmentary copy of the Book of Noah was found. It's amazing. It corresponds with the Book of Jubilees so much. And what I read to you from the Testament of Levi, that very story of Isaac preaching teaching the law of the priesthood to Levi, that was found. The same story is found in Jubilees in a much shortened form. So we see there's so many witnesses corresponding this. Jubilees matches this text really, really well. There is there was one section in this prophecy after the priesthood laws in the Greek version that's not found in the Hebrew or Aramaic fragments of the longer text, but that's probably because most of the Testament of Levi is missing in the fragments. We only have portions of it preserved. So basically, in this extra little prophecy found in the Greek text, we are Levi says, "Behold, I am clear from your ungodliness and transgression, which ye shall commit in the end of the ages against the Savior of the world, the Anointed One, acting godlessly, deceiving Israel, and stirring up against it great evils from the Lord. And ye shall deal lawlessly together with Israel, so he shall not bear with Jerusalem because of your wickedness, but the veil of the temple shall be rent so as not to cover your shame. And ye shall be scattered as captives among the Gentiles, and shall be for a reproach and for a curse there. For the house which the Lord shall choose shall be called Jerusalem, as is contained in the book of Enoch the righteous." I'll say several things about that. First, this is an amazing prophecy of the Messiah. However, I want to make a clarifier here. It is possible that in the original text, it didn't actually say Jerusalem by name, because we see sometimes in manuscripts, in some copies, it doesn't mention the name, and then in other copies, it mentions the name. Like in 2nd Ezra, some copies it says the Messiah, and other copies it says Jesus Christ. Technically, it's always possible it said the name, but it's more likely that the original didn't have a name, and that it was added later by scribes. So similarly, this was probably a prophecy of the Holy Mountain, the capital, but perhaps it was not known as Jerusalem yet. However, I will say this in support of the possibility Jerusalem was truly being prophesied of, is that in the Book of Abraham, it was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls too, in that, Abraham tells us that remember Melchizedek was king of Salem? Abraham says that Salem was also known as Jerusalem at that time. So if that's true, then it is very possible that God had already told them at this time that Jerusalem is going to be the place where the temple is to be built. And in one of the books we no longer have, like in the book of Jacob, Jubilees tells us that there was a book of Jacob that was once written. And so in that text, we might have been told that Jerusalem is the place. Because some people, when they say Jerusalem, they might think this is not a valid prophecy, it was written after the fact, but we have to look into the possibility that it scribes added Jerusalem, or that somehow they knew about Jerusalem because God had revealed it to them that that's the place he wanted it to be. And he says that the place which the Lord shall choose shall be called Jerusalem, as is contained in the book of Enoch, the righteous. But when we read in the book of Enoch, we don't see that specifically. We don't see Jerusalem by name mentioned. Either it's talking about a different book of Enoch, or because Enoch does prophesy of the temple in Jerusalem, it just doesn't call it by name Jerusalem, but it does prophesy of that temple being in that very place. So, but it's amazing because here we see Levi is confirming the book of Enoch, just like in the New Testament, Jude, the brother of the Messiah, quotes Enoch as true prophecy. Levi himself here is quoting Enoch as true prophecy, and he quoted the book of Noah. Remember, in the Dead Sea Scroll version, the longer version, he's quoting the book of Noah too. So we're seeing that these people did not, a lot of people have the misunderstanding that the patriarchs did not have scriptures, but the truth is they did. They had Enoch's scripture, Noah's scripture, Abraham, Jacob's scripture, and the Testament's scripture. There's a lot of scriptures that were written in these times and that they were using. All throughout the Testaments of the 12 patriarchs, the patriarchs appeal to the book of Enoch. Not in every testament, but in most of the testaments, they quote the book of Enoch as saying, it is written in the book of Enoch, I read it in the book of Enoch that this prophecy was going to happen. So it's amazing confirmation of what we're studying from the scrolls. Now I'm going to continue, and in the Testament of Levi, it says, in the Greek version, therefore, when I took a wife, I was 28 years old, and her name was Melka, and she conceived and bare a son, and I called his name Gersem, for we were sojourners in our land. And I saw concerning him that he would not be in the first rank. And Kohath was born in the 35th year of my life, towards sunrise. And I saw in a vision that he was standing on high in the midst of all congregation. Therefore I called his name Kohath, which is beginning of majesty and instruction. And she bare me a third son, Merari, in the 40th year of my life. And since his mother bare him with difficulty, I called him Merari, that is, my bitterness, because he also was like to die. And Jochebed was born in Egypt in my 64th year, for I was renowned then in the midst of my brethren. And Gersom took a wife, and she bare to him Lamni and Semei, and the sons of Kohath, Amram, Issachar, Hebron, and Uzziel, and the sons of Merari, Muli and Musias, or Muses. It's not Moses, but it's similar to Moses. And in my 94th year, Amram took Jochebed, my daughter, to him to wife, for they were born in one day, he and my daughter. 8 years old was I when I went into the land of Canaan, and 18 years when I slew Shechem, and at 19 years I became priest, and at 28 years I took a wife, and at 48 I went into Egypt. And behold, my children, ye are a third generation. In my 118th year, Joseph died. I'll stop there for a second. So that was the Greek text. Now, a question was asked by Sean. Yeah, the books of the Testament, they came before Moses. Here's what we have. Abraham had a son, Isaac. Isaac had a son, Jacob. Jacob had his 12 sons. One of those sons was Levi. Levi had a son, Kohath. Kohath had a son, Amram. Amram had a son, Moses. And then Moses, when he was 80 years old, then he led Israel out of the Exodus. So the testaments of the 12 patriarchs, those are the 12 sons of Jacob. The 12 sons of Jacob died before Moses was even born. So their testaments were spoken by those people, by those men, and written down before Moses. And the Torah says that Moses took the body of Joseph into Egypt. Now, Sean also, the other Sean says, I think it's the other Sean. I think that we have two Seans with us. He says, it goes over my head why this isn't more widely accepted. Seems like there is a massive amount of evidence pointing to the validity of the documents found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And yeah, it's very strange, but the reason is ignorance. Most people are not even aware of the existence of these things. Secondly, these books are apocrypha. They're secret. That's what apocrypha means, secret books. So even though it's been translated and published, it's still secret because very few are aware of it. Even though it's there available for people to find, it's so unpopular that pretty much no one knows about it because no one's talking about it. So it's like it's buried in libraries with very few people knowing about it. It's just amazing stuff. When you read these things, and I believe these are key documents to restore the true faith, the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's what we gotta focus on to restore, to go back to the Nazarene faith of the ancient times, to follow the Messiah in his footsteps. Because I believe the Messiah was in the same faith that the Dead Sea Scrolls were too. So, pretty much, like with Christians, a huge amount of the world is Christians, like maybe a third of the whole world. 2 billion people or more, and they are so focused on their traditions, they don't even consider other books a possibility. So they never even read these books. Protestants, Catholics, pretty much all these people. The only church which has, in ancient times, there were medieval ages, there were churches that used the testaments and valued them. The Armenian Orthodox Church, which separated from the Roman Catholics about 1500 years ago. So they separated from, they broke away from the Catholic Church a long time ago, much longer than the Protestants. And they were much more open to other writings, the Armenian Orthodox. And in their writings, in some copies of their Bibles, they have the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. Although it's an even shorter form in the Armenian version, but still, they have that shorter text as part of their Bibles. And in some lists of the Bible, they include it as scripture. They say that this is divinely inspired. So we see that it wasn't completely ignored by everyone, but the vast majority it was ignored. Here's another thing. These texts are so interconnected. Like, it talks about the Book of Enoch, for instance. So the basic idea is a lot of people thought the Book of Enoch was evil and false. So if the Testaments are confirming Enoch and Enoch is false, then the Testaments have to be false too. They're so interconnected that if you take one piece away, it starts knocking down all the other pieces too. Or if you say one is true, it starts putting all the other pieces together and establishing them as true. So it's amazing how connected everything is. And so we see most of the world are closed-minded Christians that have never even read these things. They've already concluded in their mind these aren't true writings and they don't care what they say. Then you've got Muslims, like 2 billion Muslims. They're obviously not going to really read these with any validity because they don't even accept the regular Bible as valid. And atheists, because the Christians aren't using it much, they're not reading this stuff either. So it really is amazing how secret these things are. There's so many apocrypha books. I have a list of books that I consider scripture. Even if some of those books are not scripture, the point is, there's so many extra books that people aren't aware of. I have on my list on my website, over 300 books of scripture, including the regular books of the Bible, over 300 books. That's amazing. So much information that people are not reading. Jackson, can you clarify your question? Oh, why? I think you mean why any canon at all. Right. Why does there have to even be a canon? Yeah, does man have the right to put it into a canon and say only these books are scripture? Because the possibility is new books can be added or new books can be found. So a canon, basically, you know, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church is the closest thing we want to get to the truth. And basically, the Ethiopian, what they have the main canon, which everyone is allowed access to. Then they have a larger canon, which says some of these books are secret, not to be shared with everybody. But here's the key. The Ethiopians have a very different view of canon. In their view, their canon is not, these are all the books of scripture. Their canon is, these are all the books of scripture we know for certain are scripture. They're not saying nothing else is scripture. They're just giving you, this is what we know to be true. And we ought to accept this, because these are divinely inspired for certain. So that's the kind of, that's a concept of canon that I can support. Let's give a list of books that we know for certain are, or at least what we believe, but let's not be closed-minded and say, okay, nothing else can be scripture. You know, right, the minimum of what we're confident in. So I think that the concept of canon can be valid so long as we're not abusing it as a way of being closed-minded, you know. Canon is just basically, you know, giving a rule or regulation of how to worship. The word for canon, you know, is sometimes used for not just the Bible, but for other regulations of the church too, of like laws that they have. I think canons can be okay as long as, like, for some churches, like the Ethiopian, they have 8 extra books in their Bible. And in several of those books, they have multiple lists of canons, and the lists contradict each other. But in the Ethiopian mind, they say contradicting lists does not contradict itself, because, again, the canon is not giving a list of all scripture. It's just giving a list of these books were confirmed in this council, these books were confirmed in this council. The council did not say all these other books are false, it just said these ones are true. So if you have two lists that differ, but both of them are saying these books are true, then you just put them together and say, okay, well, they're all true in both lists. And so that's the concept of the Ethiopians. Their view of canon was much more loose and embracing of other writings. There's several other writings not part of their canon, which they seem to accept as scripture, like the secret book of Isaiah, called the Ascension of Isaiah. Shepherd of Hermas, they seem to accept that. And maybe a couple others, like Joseph and Asenath. But so, it's just amazing. You're right, Sean. It's truly boggling. Who knows? We might only go through the one testament. I was hoping to do the two testaments, but at this rate, I'm not sure. No, I think we'll have time to do that. The second one is the Testament of Naphtali. I'll do that. And that one's much shorter, so it won't take as long to do that one. But so I'm only going to be doing those two today. I don't think I'll have time to do any of the others. So I'll finish the Testament of Levi and then deal with Naphtali, and that'll be it for this week's teaching. So that passage I read in the Greek text of the family history of Levi, here's the same passage that were found in the Aramaic fragments. It says, "And when 4 weeks were fulfilled for me with regard to the years of my life, in the 28th year I took a wife for myself from the kin of Abraham my father, Milcah, daughter of Bethuel, son of Laban, brother of my mother. And when she had become pregnant by me, she gave birth to a first son, and I called his name Gershon, for I said that my seed shall be a sojourner in a land where I was born. We are sojourners like this one in the land reckoned as ours. And concerning this, the little boy, I myself saw in my vision that he and his seed shall be expelled from the high priesthood. I was 30 years old in my life when he was born, and he was born in the 10th month at the setting of the sun. And it came about, according to the fitting proper time of woman, that I was with her, and she became pregnant again by me, and she bore to me another son, and called his name Kohath. And I saw that the assembly of all the people would be his, and that the great high priesthood of all Israel would be his. In the 34th year of my life he was born, in the first month, on the first of the month, with the rising of the sun. And I was with her yet again, and she bore me a third son, and I called his name Merari, because it was bitter to me concerning him very much, because when he was born he was on the point of death, and it was very bitter to me concerning him, inasmuch as he was about to die. And I requested and made supplication concerning him, and it was utter bitterness. In the 40th year of my life she gave birth in the third month. And once more I was with her yet again, and she became pregnant, and she bore me a daughter, and I assigned the name Jochebed. I said, as she was born to me, for value she was born to me, for the glory of Israel. In the 64th year of my life she was born, on the first of the seventh month, after he brought us into Egypt. In the 16th year, we entered into the land of Egypt, and to my sons, the daughters of my brother, at the time corresponding to their ages. To them, sons, the name of the sons of Gershon, Libni and Shimi, and the name of the sons of Kohath, Amram, Yizhar, Hebron, and Uzziel, and the name of the sons of Merari, Mali and Mushi. And Amram took my daughter Jochebed for himself as wife while I was alive in the 94th year of my life, and I called Amram's name Amram when he was born, because I said when he was born, this one shall lead the people from the land of Egypt. Thus his name is called the lifted up people. On one and the same day, behold, he, Jochebed, my daughter, were born. At age 18 years, I was brought into the land of Canaan, and when I was 18 years old, I killed Shechem, and I annihilated the doers of violence. And at 19 years, I became a priest, and at age 28 years, I married me a wife. And I was 48 years old when we were brought into the land of Egypt, and I lived 89 years in Egypt. And all the days of my life are 137 years. And I have seen third generation sons, and I'm not yet dead. And in the 118th year of my life, the year in which Joseph my brother died, I called to my sons and to their sons, and I began to tell them my last wishes, everything that was in my heart. So I'll stop there. You see, it corresponds exactly with the Greek text, but it's longer. In the Greek text, it gave less details. In the Aramaic fragments, it started giving, like, this one was born when the sun was rising and when the sun was setting, and this and that. It was giving much more detail about why he named them, the names they named. So much more depth in the Aramaic fragments. So we're seeing, wow, the testament that we have of Levi is much shorter than the original text. Jackson made a comment about Merari being Akhenaten's high priest. I'm not sure about that, but what would be interesting to do is basically figure out when were the Israelites in Egypt, because there's a lot of uncertainty about that. We're still trying to figure that out. A lot of scholars are not sure. Some people say the Hyksos during that time. There's a lot of debate because it's not really clear. But if we accept the scriptures as authentic and trustworthy, we know that the Israelites were there. We just don't know when yet. We haven't found it yet. And the history of Egypt is a little confusing. There's a lot of disagreements by scholars as to the correct chronology, when history was. So there's a lot more research we have to do to see where Israel fits in the history of Egypt. Then I'm gonna continue here. I'm getting close to the end of Testament of Levi, of what I want to share from that. I'll continue and say, so in the Greek text it says, in my 118th year Joseph died, and now my children I command you, fear the Lord your God with your whole heart, and walk in simplicity according to all his law. And do ye also teach your children letters, that they may have understanding all their life, reading unceasingly the law of God. For every one that knoweth the law of the Lord shall be honored, and shall not be a stranger whithersoever he goeth. Yea, many friends shall he gain more than his parents, and many men shall desire to serve him, and to hear the law from his mouth. Work righteousness, therefore, my children, upon the earth, that ye may have as a treasure in heaven. And sow good things in your souls, that ye may find them in your life. But if you sow evil things, you shall reap every trouble and affliction. Get wisdom in the fear of God with diligence. For though there be a leading into captivity, and cities and lands be destroyed, and gold and silver and every possession perish, the wisdom of the wise not can take away, save the blindness of ungodliness and the callousness of sin. For if one keep oneself from these evil things, then even among his enemies shall wisdom be a glory to him, and in a strange country a fatherland, and in the midst of foes shall prove a friend. Whosoever teacheth noble things and doeth them shall be enthroned with kings, as was also Joseph my brother. So stop there for a second. Some of the things that Levi says, some people might say, I'm not sure about that. Like, for instance, he said, if you do the law, you will be honored amongst pagans, basically. They will like you. But there's other passages that seem to say that we will be hated and persecuted. I think there's two ways to look at it. Both are true in their context. Just like Solomon says in the book of Proverbs, rebuke a fool or answer a fool in his folly. And then in the very next verse says, don't answer a fool in his folly. But you see, in the two contexts, he's saying, don't answer a fool in his folly in order that you have this result. Answer him if you want this result. So in the same way, when we keep the law, we can have enemies who persecute us, but we can also have people who value us and honor us. It's all part of the people who we're communicating with and how they respond to our righteousness. The fact is, if you have a lot of money and you're giving a lot of money to the poor and feeding people and helping people and healing people, they're going to like you even if they're pagans. If you're a very kind and loving person, a lot of people are going to like you. However, if you oppose someone personally, that's when they start taking it to a persecuting you. Once you get in the way of something and you take away something that they like. But if you're someone who is showing the glory of the law and you're doing justice and goodness in the land, people like justice when it benefits them. So when they see how faithful and honest you are, the sincere Gentiles will glorify you for that and honor you. So, and it'll give you blessings, just like Joseph. Joseph was raised to the second command in Egypt. Why? Because he was such a holy and righteous man. Even the people who tried to plot against him, they failed, and then they apologized to him and said, you were innocent and we should not have done that to you. But every time he was thrown into prison, he became the leader in prison. He was so loved because he was such a good guy. And then Pharaoh, after throwing him in prison, he afterwards needed his help and then realized the mistake he had made and said, I need you to be the leader here. Help protect Egypt. So it's just amazing that once we obey the law, we can be such a good influence in the world. If we have to be wise, crafty as serpents, innocent as doves. So it's a wisdom here that we are helping the world, but we also have to be innocent in how we do it. And then Levi also spoke of the value of reading the law. It's very important to learn by reading. A lot of people don't know how to read. In the past, that was true. And even today, a lot of people are not very well learned in that. And even if they know how to read, they don't read a lot. They like to watch TV or do other stuff that's stupid. But Levi emphasizes to us the importance of learning how to read and then reading the law. We need to learn how to read so we can study the scriptures. So that's why Levi said, do ye also teach your children letters, that they may have understanding all their life, reading unceasingly the law of God. So it's just a wonderful teaching for us that it encourages us. And we know that if we did not have the ability to read and we didn't have a law, that would make us much harder time finding the truth and being righteous. So now the Aramaic fragments of that passage were preserved. But here's the problem. That what we see in the Aramaic version is much longer, and it preserves almost nothing of what it says here. So how I interpret that is, just like we find in Deuteronomy and other books of the Old Testament, not only were passages removed, but they were also rearranged too. So I think everything that the Greek version says here was in the original text, but it was in a different place a little bit later, and that there was a much longer introduction that Levi gave. So I'm going to read from a fragment here from what we see in the Aramaic fragments. It says, "And in the 118th year of my life, the year in which Joseph my brother died, I called to my sons and to their sons, and I began to tell them my last wishes, everything that was in my heart. I answered and said to my sons, hear the word of Levi your father, and heed the last wishes of the one cherished by God. I am telling you my last wishes, my sons, and I am revealing the truth to you, my dear ones. The chief most of your works should be the truth, and forever let it reside with you. If you sow righteousness and truth, you shall bring in a blessed and good crop. He who sows what is good brings in what is good, and he who sows evil, his seed returns upon him. And now, my sons, teach your sons book, tradition, wisdom, and let wisdom be with you for eternal honor. He who teaches wisdom, honor is in it, but he who despises wisdom is given over to contempt. See, my sons, Joseph, my brother, who was a teacher of book, tradition, wisdom, for honor and greatness and to kings, do not forgo wisdom to teach. Man who, remember, when I give pauses, that means there's something missing. Man who teaches wisdom all his days, and increased, to every land and province into which he enters a brother, in it, he is not a stranger in it, not resembling in it a stranger, and not resembling in it one of mixed ancestry, because all of them give to him honor in it, because all want to learn from his wisdom. His friends are many, and those who seek his welfare are great ones, and they enthrone him on the throne, on a throne of glory, in order to hear his words of wisdom. His wisdom is great wealth that is honor and a good treasure to all who acquire it. If powerful kings come and a multitudinous people, and an army and cavalry and many chariots with them, and they remove possessions of land and province, and they despoil all that is in them, they shall not despoil the treasuries of wisdom, nor shall they find its hidden things, and they shall not enter its gates, and not its good things shall they be able to overcome its walls, and not they shall see its treasure, and there is no price corresponding to it. He seeks wisdom, the wisdom. He hides it from him, and not lacking. All seekers, truth. And now, my sons, book and tradition, wisdom. I saw in a vision that you shall inherit them. Great. You shall give honor. Also in the books, chiefs and judges and slaves. Also priests and kings. Your kingdom shall be, and there is no end to, shall pass from you unto all with great honor." There's some other fragments, but that's pretty much the end of those Aramaic fragments, the main gist of it. So you can see, wow, that matches very well, but it's much longer and in-depth. It's very cool to see a taste of what the original Testament of Levi was. So let me see how many more chapters here. I'm going to go through quickly the rest of Testament of Levi. We're more than halfway through the Greek Testament of Levi, so I'll go quickly through the rest of this. So after that advice in the Greek, it says, "Therefore, my children, I have learnt that at the end of the ages you will transgress against the Lord, stretching out hands to wickedness against him, and to all the Gentiles shall ye become a scorn. For our father Israel is pure from the transgressions of the chief priests, who shall lay their hands upon the Savior of the world. For as the heaven is purer in the Lord's sight than the earth, so also be ye the lights of Israel than all the Gentiles. But if you be darkened through transgressions, what therefore will all the Gentiles do living in blindness? Yea, you shall bring a curse upon our race, because the light of the law, which was given for to lighten every man, this ye desire to destroy by teaching commandments contrary to the ordinances of God. The offerings of the Lord you shall rob, and from his portion shall ye steal choice portions, eating contemptuously with harlots. And out of covetousness ye shall teach the commandments of the Lord. Wedded women you shall pollute, and the virgins of Jerusalem shall ye defile. And with harlots and adulteresses shall ye be joined. And the daughters of the Gentiles shall ye take to wife, purifying them with an unlawful purification. And your union shall be like unto Sodom and Gomorrah. And you shall be puffed up because of your priesthood, lifting yourselves up against men, and not only so, but also against the commands of God. For ye shall contemn the holy things with jests and laughter. Therefore the temple which the Lord shall choose shall be laid waste through your uncleanness, and ye shall be captives throughout all nations. And ye shall be an abomination unto them, and ye shall receive reproach and everlasting shame from the righteous judgment of God. And all of you, and all who hate you, shall rejoice at your destruction. And if you were not to receive mercy through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, our fathers, not one of our seed should be left upon the earth. All right, I'll stop there for now. Remember, Moses said, it was not because of your righteousness that you were chosen as a nation, but it was because of the promises given to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, because they were righteous, and they were given a covenant. That's kind of what Levi was just saying right there at that very last thing. But so we have a prophecy here. Levi gives the prophecy of the Messiah, and of the sins that the priests, the Levites, are going to do. A very in-depth, detailed list of sins, and we see that the priesthood got corrupt. That's why the Essenes fled from the priesthood of Jerusalem, because they believed that they were being an abomination. They rejected their priesthood. And so, let's see here. It talked about how they teach commandments contrary to the ordinance of God. That's the traditions of men, their extra oral law stuff. It's amazing, a clear prophecy of the sins of the false priests. And it also prophesies of them abandoning the law of the priesthood that was in the temple scroll. Because the priests, they were responsible for rejecting the original temple law and replacing it with the inferior copies of Deuteronomy. So we see Levi correctly prophesies of the Levitical priesthood's wickedness that would come in the latter days. And also want to say one thing. Earlier, when I was reading from Testament of Levi, when I mentioned the Book of Enoch, how he quoted it, referred to it, he mentioned the veil. There was going to be the destruction of the veil and why the veil would be torn. It would be a sign that they would be rejected. And so I believe the Essenes, when they saw the veil torn, that's what the New Testament tells us happened when the Messiah died. They saw that as a sign in fulfillment of what Levi prophesied and said, okay, now the priesthood has been rejected. And now Jerusalem is going to be destroyed soon. Because we see the sign of the veil. That was the sign that they were supposed to see. It doesn't mean what the Christians say, that the veil was torn, so now we don't need the sacrifices anymore. The veil was torn because the priesthood was rejected for being an evil priesthood. And a good lesson for us from these laws about what the priests would do in their sins. One of them says, you shall contemn the holy things with jests and laughter. A lot of people like to make jokes, and sometimes they make jokes about God and things of righteousness. And we got to be very careful when we're joking about God or the Bible or anything, because if we're mocking something or making fun of something the Bible says, we could be judged for that. Because as James says, and the Messiah says, we will be judged for every idle word that we speak. And idle words include jokes we make. So we got to be very careful of how we treat the holy things. We don't want to make little of them. We want to highly reverence them. Just like the Sabbath, we don't want to make fun of the Sabbath and make jokes about breaking the Sabbath. You know, we don't want to desecrate the Sabbath's character and integrity. In the same way, we don't want to do that to anything holy or righteous. And so Levi prophesied that the temple would be destroyed. Now, I said in another one of the earlier Bible studies that we did a few weeks ago of the 10 weeks prophecy. I'm not going to read through that again because I already read through that. Or excuse me, 70 weeks prophecy, 490 years. So I won't go through that again in reading through all that, but I'll read the final part, okay? I'll read the parts about the Messiah. I'm not going to read any of the other parts that refer to the priesthood being corrupt. But basically, he prophesies of the priesthood after the second temple is built. From then until the time of the Messiah, he tells about the high priesthood and how for the first seven jubilees, the priesthood gets more and more corrupt. Then there's a small revival, which is the Maccabees, but then it goes right really bad, and then it completely becomes illegitimate for the high priesthood. So the 8th, 9th, and 10th jubilees, there's no legitimate high priesthood anymore, according to Levi's words. And one other thing. So that's an amazing stuff that I read of the prophecies. Imagine how much longer and deeper the original text was of that prophecy, which we're now missing. It just blows your mind thinking what we're missing of some of this stuff. It must have been much more powerful of a prophecy. So he says, Levi says, "And now I have learned that for 70 weeks you shall go astray and profane the priesthood and pollute the sacrifices. And ye shall make void the law, and set at naught the words of the prophets, but evil perverseness. And ye shall persecute righteous men, and hate the godly. The words of the faithful shall ye abhor. And a man who reneweth the law and the power of the Most High, ye shall call a deceiver. And at last ye shall rush to slay him, not knowing his dignity, taking innocent blood through wickedness upon your heads. And your holy places shall be laid waste, even to the ground because of him. And ye shall have no place that is clean, but ye shall be among the Gentiles a curse and a dispersion, until he shall again visit you, and in pity shall receive you through faith and water." So that's prophesying of the Messiah. But Jackson was saying, "Great exposition. I appreciate your compliment, brother. It's always good to have you with us, and I know you really value my scholarship on a lot of this, especially the Dead Sea Scroll stuff. So I thank you so much for your positive contribution." And then, as I said, I'm going to skip most of that prophecy of the weeks, but I'm going to say the very last thing. "And in the seventh week shall come priests, idolaters, adulterers." This is the seventh week of the seventh jubilee. Okay. "So in the seventh week shall come priests, idolaters, adulterers, lovers of money, proud, lawless, lascivious, abusers of children and beasts. And after their punishment shall have come from the Lord, the priesthood shall fail. Then shall the Lord raise up a new priest, and to him all the words of the Lord shall be revealed. And he shall execute a righteous judgment upon the earth for a multitude of days. And his star," you know, the Book of Numbers talks about this star prophecy, "his star shall arise in heaven as of a king, lighting up the light of knowledge as the sun the day, and he shall be magnified in the world. He shall shine forth as the sun on the earth, and shall remove all darkness from under heaven. And there shall be peace in all the earth. The heaven shall exult in his days, and the earth shall be glad, and the clouds shall rejoice, and the knowledge of the Lord shall be poured forth upon the earth, as the water of the seas, and the angels of the glory of the presence of the Lord shall be glad in him. The heavens shall be opened, and from the temple of glory shall come upon him sanctification, with the Father's voice, as from Abraham to Isaac. And the glory of the Most High shall be uttered over him, and the spirit of understanding and sanctification shall rest upon him in the water. For he shall give the majesty of the Lord to his sons in truth forevermore. And there shall none succeed him for all generations forever. And in his priesthood the Gentiles shall be multiplied in knowledge upon the earth, and enlightened through the grace of the Lord. In his priesthood shall sin come to an end, and the lawless shall cease to do evil, and the just shall rest in him. And he shall open the gates of paradise, and shall remove the threatening sword against Adam. And he shall give to the saints to eat from the tree of life, and the spirit of holiness shall be on them. And Belial shall be bound by him, and he shall give power to his children to tread upon the evil spirits. And the Lord shall rejoice in his children, and be well pleased in his beloved ones forever. Then shall Abraham and Isaac and Jacob exult, and I will be glad, and all the saints shall clothe themselves with joy." That's a long prophecy of the Messiah coming. I find it very powerful and legitimate prophecy. And as I said, the original version must have been much longer and deeper, so that's pretty cool. This is the final Testament of Levi. There's like chapters, but the chapters are often teeny tiny chapters. And now we're on the final tiny chapter of Testament of Levi in the Greek version. So he says, "And now, my children, you have heard all. Choose therefore for yourselves either the light or the darkness, either the law of the Lord or the works of Belial." And his sons answered him, and saying, "Before the Lord we will walk according to his law." And their father said unto them, "The Lord is witness, and his angels are witnesses, and ye are witnesses, and I am witness, concerning the word of your mouth." And his sons said unto him, "We are witnesses." And thus Levi ceased commanding his sons, and it says he died, and they buried him. He died at 137 years old. So that's the Testament of Levi. It took so long to do that Testament of Levi, but I think it was really good what we were able to say for that. So now, since we're getting close to the end, I'm only going to do the one more testament. If any of you have to leave now, like if Jackson, you have to go, perhaps now would be a good time because I'm going to be starting the next testament. So we finished the Testament of Levi. I hope you really enjoyed that first testament. There was so much amazing stuff in it. So I'm going to go to the next one, Testament of Naphtali. That's the only other one I'll do because... Yeah, I was going to try to do four. I was being so naive. All right, Jackson. If you have to go, you can listen to the rest of this on the recording. I'm glad you were able to make it for this. Shalom. Thank you for coming. I was going to do originally four testaments in this. I was so naive to think I could fit it all in. The other two that I was going to do was Judah's and Joseph's. And those are the longest testaments in Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. So that was very stupid of me. But I will try to do Judah and Joseph, our next Bible study, which is going to be this Sunday, if you guys are able to attend that, because the last study I did was last Sunday. So it's almost been 2 full weeks. So in a few days, I'm going to do it. I'm going to set back to the original by doing it Sunday. So if you can all join on Sunday, this Sunday, that would be awesome, and we can continue this. But so I'll do. Okay, Sharon, you have to go. This is going to be on YouTube, so I really hope you enjoyed it and that you will listen to the second half of it. And she left already. Oh well. The rest of you guys can stay. And finish the Testament of Naphtali. I'll only be doing this for about 30 more minutes. So if you guys can stay for that, that would be awesome. Okay, good. Looks like you guys will be able to stay. And Jackson, you can stay as long as you want. And then when you have to go, feel free to just go. So it's amazing because... Like as I said, the Testament of Levi was found in fragments in the Dead Sea Scrolls in Aramaic only. There's no Hebrew fragments of Testament of Levi that were found. Only Aramaic. Then there was a Hebrew version of Testament of Naphtali found in Cairo Genizah, or not. I don't think it was Cairo Genizah, but it was found amongst the rabbis. A Hebrew version. Not the full thing preserved, but a huge chunk of it. And then in the Dead Sea Scrolls, Hebrew fragments of the Testament of Naphtali were found. So that's a very strange coincidence to me that there was only Aramaic fragments of Testament of Levi 1,000 years ago, and then the Dead Sea Scrolls only Aramaic. And then there was a Hebrew version of Naphtali 1,000 years ago, and then Hebrew fragments of Testament of Naphtali in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And then what's even more strange, those are the only two testaments which were found 1,000 years ago, and the only two testaments in the Dead Sea Scrolls that were found. The other 10 testaments were not really found at all. Some scholars think maybe the Testament of Judah, I think Judah was found, but the fragment is so tiny and it's very unclear if it's even from the Testament of Judah, so we won't even consider that as from the Testament of Judah. So it's the coincidence. So many coincidences are piling up with the Dead Sea Scrolls. It convinces me, no, it's not coincidence. It has to be evidence of divine inspiration, and that he's trying to show us the scriptures, like restore the scriptures to us. So basically, when we see the Testament of Levi in the Greek, Testament of Levi and Naphtali in the Greek, and compare it to the longer versions, it tells us, okay, well, if the Naphtali is not that big. In the Greek version, Naphtali is pretty short. And yet we find a much longer one. So this proves to us that the original version of all 12 Testaments was much longer. Because if it was Levi, you could think with Levi, well, maybe it was only Levi that was longer and all the other ones were shorter. But no, Naphtali was longer too. So Naphtali was not that important compared to Levi. And if Naphtali has a much longer testament, then all the other ones have to too. It has to be the case. So the two that were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls is Levi and Naphtali. Only in tiny fragments, though. Very little fragments. There's much more preserved in fragments that were found 1,000 years ago of these two. But the Dead Sea Scrolls preserved a few fragments of those two testaments. So it proves to us that they considered it scripture and authoritative. Found in what location? In the fourth cave, they were found. Cave 1 and Cave 4, they were found. In the Qumran area. I don't know the exact location, but those are that's where they were found. And then the Arabs, they took all them, took them away, and then said, I will sell them back to you for a lot of money. So they were very greedy. But okay, so you mean where in the rest of the book? So you're talking about in the rest of the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, the two that were found? Basically, the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs in the manuscripts that we have, they differ in the order of the Testaments. The primary order, though, is the order of the first, like, of which was born first. So, and then the other 10 testaments, they're just in the Greek version in a shortened text. The original long version is completely gone for all the other testaments. We have no fragments of those preserved. It's just a coincidence that we don't have those anymore, and that Levi and Naphtali fragments of those were found. It's just because for some reason God only wanted those two to be found for now. Not because only those two are important. It's just for his higher reasons. They destroyed through the process of time. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, you see, like, so much of these books are fragmentary. Like, and so much is missing. Like, for the Book of Chronicles, there's, like, a fragment of Chronicles, which is about this size, and the entire rest of the book is gone. So we can see, if the whole Book of Chronicles is missing and only one little fragment is preserved, it's very easy for whole scrolls of the Testaments to be mostly gone. But it's also likely that the Testaments were so large, much larger in the original version, that instead of being included as one book, they might have been copied on different scrolls separately. That's a possibility. And that's why maybe only Levi and Naphtali were found, because they were only on a single scroll. But so now I'm going to go through Naphtali, okay? And the Testament of Levi had 19 chapters. Remember, chapters were small chapters. So the Testament of Naphtali, let's see how many they have. It has 9 chapters only. So we'll go through that. So Naphtali starts off, he gathers his children, he was in good health. He says, when his sons were gathered together in the 7th month, on the first day of the month, while still in good health, he made them a feast of food and wine. And after he was awake in the morning, he said to them, I am dying, and they believed him not. And as he glorified the Lord, he grew strong and said that after yesterday's feast, he should die. So that's pretty crazy. Then he starts teaching them about his life and about certain things. He says, And he began, it says, he began to say them, "Hear, my children, you sons of Naphtali, hear the words of your father. I was born from Bilhah, and because Rachel dealt craftily and gave Bilhah in place of herself to Jacob, and she conceived and bare me upon Rachel's knees, therefore she called my name Naphtali. For Rachel loved me very much because I was born upon her lap. And when I was still young, she was wont to kiss me and say, may I have a brother of thine from my own womb like unto thee. Once also Joseph was like unto me in all things, according to the prayers of Rachel." So they must have looked very similar, even though they weren't both from Rachel. But they were both from Jacob. And somehow, they looked very similar to Naphtali. Must have had a lot of his genes of appearance from Jacob, and the same from Joseph. They must have been a lot from Jacob, but Joseph was more like Rachel. But they were similar enough so that they were alike in appearance, Naphtali and Joseph. So that's very interesting. It tells us information about who he was born from, and the name of why he was named when he was named. And so then he says, "Now my mother was Bilhah, daughter of Rotheus, the brother of Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, who was born on one and the selfsame day with Rachel." So Deborah was born on the same day as Rachel. And he goes on and says, "And Rotheus was of the family of Abraham, a Chaldean, God-fearing, freeborn, and noble. And he was taken captive and was bought by Laban. And he gave him Una, his handmaid, to wife. And she bore a daughter and called her name Zilpah, after the name of the village in which he had been taken captive. And next she bore Bilhah, saying, my daughter hasteneth after what is new. For immediately that she was born, she seized the breast and hastened to suck it." It's amazing because in the Bible, we don't see why Zilpah was called that, or Bilhah. We don't see information about their family lineage. There's so much depth in these testaments of the family history. And it's amazing that all the people in the Hebrew, almost always, when people are named, they're named based on something that happens around their birth. Either the baby does something interesting on their birth, or the parents have a certain reaction to the birth. That's very central to Hebrew thought. So when you're naming your children in the future, if you have any future children, it is a good idea perhaps to name your children based on events surrounding the birth of that child. And you can be creative and be open to the meaning of that your child should have. Names are very important because names define who you are. If you have a name that's stupid head, through your whole life, you're going to have that on your whole mind and you're going to feel stupid because that's your name. So names are very much a part of who we are. It tells us our origin, our meaning, our purpose and mission in life very often. It just describes our character. So then, Pinhead. Sean was called Pinhead by his dad. Naphtali then goes on and says, "I was swift on my feet like the deer, and my father Jacob appointed me for all messages, and as a deer did he give me his blessing." I think he's talking about Jacob's blessing, where he refers to Naphtali as like a doe, I think, or a deer. And then Naphtali goes on and says, "For as the potter knoweth the vessel, how much it is to contain, and bringeth clay accordingly, so also doth the Lord make the body after the likeness of the spirit. And according to the capacity of the body doth he implant the spirit. And the one doth not fall short of the other by a third part of a hair, for by weight and measure and rule was all the creation made. And as the potter knoweth the use of each vessel, what it is meet for, so also doth the Lord know the body, how far it will persist in goodness, and when it beginneth in evil. For there is no inclination or thought which the Lord knoweth not, for he created every man after his own image. For as a man's strength, so also is his work. As his eye, so also is his sleep. As his soul, so also is his word, either in the law of the Lord or in the law of Belial. That's very similar to kind of language Paul was using about the vessels of wrath and how he creates us and predestines us. He goes on and says, and as there is a difference between light and darkness, between seeing and hearing, so also is there a division between man and man and between woman and woman. And it is not to be said that the one is like the other, either in face or in mind. For God made all things good in their order, the five senses in the head, and he joined on the neck to the head, adding to it the hair, also for comeliness and glory, then the heart for understanding, the belly for excrement, and the stomach for grinding, the winepipe for taking in, the liver for wrath. Remember we talked about the liver and organs being for your emotions? So liver for wrath, the gall for bitterness, the spleen for laughter, the reins for prudence, the muscles of the loins for power, the lungs for drawing in, the loins for strength, and so forth. So that's a very overview of the creation of our bodies and what the purpose is. It's a very powerful passage. And then and he says some other things. I'm going to skip some of that. He says, sun and moon and stars change not their order, so do you also change not the law of God in the disorderliness of your doings. That's exactly what Enoch says, and many other prophecies talk about. Look at the sun, moon, and stars, and learn from them. They don't change their orbits, so you shouldn't either. Obey the law, just like they obey the law. And he says, the Gentiles went astray and forsook the Lord and changed their order and obeyed stocks and stones, spirits of deceit. But ye shall not be so, my children, recognizing in the firmament, in the earth, and in the sea, and in all created things, the Lord who made all things, that ye become not as Sodom, which changed the order of nature. In like manner, the watchers also changed the order of their nature, whom the Lord cursed at the flood, on whose account he made the earth without inhabitants and fruitless. Now, Sean said, they know their place, talking about the stars and the moon and the sun. But we do know in prophecy, and Enoch tells us that some of the stars did not know their place and they sinned. So Enoch tells us to look at the sun, moon, and stars, but he's talking about the righteous ones that are obeying. Now, right now, they're all obeying as far as we know, although there might be some which are disobeying. That may be why we sometimes see the certain differences, but we do see that some of the stars are disobeying the law, and there's a place in Enoch which says that the disobedient stars will go to a place of punishment where they will be punished for 10,000 ages or years. But that word for 10,000 doesn't always mean 10,000. It can mean innumerable years. So, and then he talks about the watchers. That's strongly connected with the Enoch story. And also I wanted to say, he spoke about how you recognize in all things, the created things, the God who made all things. That's kind of what Paul says, is looking at the things of creation, his clear qualities can be seen. So that kind of corresponds. It's just kind of cool to see that correspondence. Now, immediately after he mentions the Watchers and Sodom and Gomorrah, he's connecting Sodom and Gomorrah and the Watchers. That's the exact same thing that 2 Peter and Jude do, connecting it together. So we're seeing a pattern here in Scripture, a common theme of how they quote Scripture and talk about these topics. Immediately after the Watchers, he says, these things I say unto you, my children, for I have read in the writing of Enoch, that ye yourselves also shall depart from the Lord, walking according to all the lawlessness of the Gentiles, and ye shall do according to all the wickedness of Sodom. So it's amazing. It goes like so well with Jude. We have in Jude, it says, the watchers sinned, just like Sodom and Gomorrah. And then a little bit later it says, and in the writing of Enoch, it speaks against these wickedness. And then right we have in Naphtali, in a short space, the same thing. Sodom and Gomorrah, the Watchers, and Book of Enoch against the wickedness of these men it prophesies. It's an amazing link. He says, immediately after that, Naphtali says, "And the Lord shall bring captivity upon you, and there shall ye serve your enemies, and ye shall be bowed down with every affliction and tribulation, until the Lord have consumed you all. And after ye have become minished and made few, ye shall return and acknowledge the Lord your God, and he shall bring you back into your own land according to his abundant mercy. And it shall be that after that they come into the land of their fathers, they shall again forget the Lord and become ungodly. And the Lord shall scatter them upon the face of all the earth until the compassion of the Lord shall come, a man working righteousness and working mercy unto all them that are afar off and to them that are near." That's a clear prophecy of the Messiah. So far we're seeing some amazing things there. Then Naphtali continues and talks about a vision he saw. He says, "For in the 40th year of my life, I saw a vision on the Mount of Olives, on the east of Jerusalem, that the sun and the moon were standing still. And behold, Isaac, the father of my father, said to us, 'Run and lay hold of them, each one according to his strength. And to him that seizeth them will the sun and moon belong.' And we all of us ran together, and Levi laid hold of the sun, and Judah outstripped the others and seized the moon, and they were both of them lifted up with them. And when Levi became as a sun, lo, a certain young man gave to him 12 branches of palm, and Judah was bright as the moon. And under their feet were 12 rays, and the two, Levi and Judah, ran and laid hold of them. And lo, a bull upon the earth with 2 great horns and an eagle's wings upon his back. And we wished to seize him, but could not. But Joseph came and seized him and ascended up with him on high. And I saw, for I was saying there, and behold, a holy writing appeared to us, saying, 'Assyrians, Medes, Persians, Chaldeans, Syrians shall possess in captivity the 12 tribes of Israel.' And again, after 7 days, I saw our father Jacob standing by the sea of Jamnia, and we were with him. And behold, there came a ship sailing by without sailors or pilot. And there was written upon the ship of Jacob. And our father saith to us, 'Come, let us embark on our ship.' And when we had gone on board, there arose a vehement storm and a mighty tempest of wind, and our father, who was holding the helm, departed from us. And we, being tossed with the tempest, were borne along over the sea, and the ship was filled with water, pounded by mighty waves, until it was broken up, and Joseph fled away upon a little boat, and we all were divided upon 9 planks, and Levi and Judah were together. And we were all scattered unto the ends of the earth. Then Levi, girt about with sackcloth, prayed for us all unto the Lord. And when the storm ceased, the ship reached the land as it were in peace. And lo, our father came, and we all rejoiced with one accord." So we had 2 dreams there, and they were about the 12 tribes. And we saw that Joseph was cast away. And that's talking about, the 10 tribes, the house of Joseph, cast away. And then talks about how the same, in both dreams. And then how all the other tribes went along with him, except for Levi and Judah were together. That's exactly what we see in the prophecy. All the others went into exile. And then they get returned in the end times as if nothing happened and they were in peace. And so we see, and also remember, Naphtali prophesied of the exile. Not only the first exile, but the second exile. He prophesied of both, which is amazing. And then Naphtali says, "These 2 dreams I told to my father, and he said to me, 'These things must be fulfilled in their season, after that Israel hath endured many things.' Then my father saith unto me, 'I believe God that Joseph liveth, for I see always that the Lord numbereth him with you.' And he said, weeping, 'Ah me, my son Joseph, thou livest, though I behold thee not, and thou seest not Jacob that begat thee. He caused me also therefore to weep by these words, and I burned in my heart to declare that Joseph had been sold, but I feared my brethren.'" So basically this is amazing, because that tells us, even for a while, they did not tell Jacob. They were still not telling him what happened, and it grieved him. But Jacob was told by God that Joseph still liveth, but Jacob was not sure that was true. But these visions confirmed it to him, I see that Joseph keeps being numbered in these prophecies of amongst the tribes, so he must still be alive somehow. That's what Jacob was reasoning. So we see a much greater depth to the story of Jacob and his sons. And then Naphtali goes on and says, Okay, he says, "And lo, my children, I have shown unto you the last times how everything shall come to pass in Israel. Do ye also therefore charge your children that they be united to Levi and to Judah, for through them shall salvation arise unto Israel, and in them shall Jacob be blessed. For through their tribes shall God appear, dwelling among men on earth, to save the race of Israel, and to gather together the righteous from amongst the Gentiles." And then he talks about being righteous, so I'm going to skip that part. And then he says something very interesting here. Let's see. He says, "For the commandments of the law are twofold, and through prudence must they be fulfilled." In another testament, we see the twofold nature of the commandments. So he says, "For there is a season for a man to embrace his wife, and a season to abstain therefrom for his prayer." That's exactly what Paul says. Do not abstain except by consent for the sake of prayer, which is exactly what Naphtali just said. There's a time for a season. There's a season for a man to embrace his wife, and a season to abstain for holy things. And notice he says a season, not whenever you want, every day of the year. You know, there's a season to do it. So then there are two commandments, and unless they be done in due order, they bring very great sin upon men. So also is it with the other commandments. Sounds like when he says the two commandments, he's talking about the two commandments that the Messiah said, of the love your neighbor and love God. "Be therefore wise in God, my children, and prudent, understanding the order of his commandments and the laws of every word, that the Lord may love you." And then it says, after he said those words, he told them to bury him in Hebron with his fathers. It says, "When he had eaten and drunken with a merry heart, he covered his face and died." So he was right. He was going to die right after their feast, and he did. So that's the Greek version. Now, we have a little time left, and I'm going to show you the longer version. The whole thing of it was not preserved, and I want to warn you that this is from a rabbinic midrash. And what I found is that some of the rabbinic midrashes, they preserve fragments of the Apocrypha, the scriptures, but they sometimes add their own comments into it, which are very rabbinic. So some of the things that I'll read, you'll see, well, that's probably rabbinic what he said, but for the most of it, it's legit. It's the original long version of Naphtali. So here's what it says. I'm reading from this book. It says, "When Naphtali had grown old, and had come to a good old age, and had completed his years of strength, and fulfilled the duty of the earthborn man, he began to command his children, and he said unto them, My children, come and draw near, and receive the commands of your father. And they answered and said unto him, Lo, we hearken to fulfill all that thou commandest us. And he said unto them, I do not command you concerning my silver, nor concerning my gold, nor all my substance that I leave unto you here under the sun, nor do I command you any difficult thing which you may not be able to accomplish. But I speak to you about an easy matter which you can fulfill. And his sons answered and replied a second time, and said, Speak, O Father, for we listen. He said unto them, I give you no command save in regard to the fear of the Lord. Him shall ye serve, and to him shall ye cleave. They said unto him, What need hath he of our service? He said unto them, It is not that he hath need of any creature, but that all creatures of the world have need of him. He hath not created the world for naught, but that his creatures should fear him, and that none should do to his neighbor what he doth not like for himself. They said unto him, Our father, hast thou forsooth seen us departing from thy ways, or from the ways of our fathers, either to the right or to the left? He said unto them, The Lord and I are witnesses that it is even as you say, but I dread that which is to come, lest ye go astray after the gods of strange nations, and walk according to the ordinances of the peoples of the lands, lest ye join the children of Joseph instead of the children of Levi and the children of Judah. They said unto him, What dost thou see that thou commandest us in this wise? He said unto them, Because I know that one day the children of Joseph will depart from the Lord, the God of their fathers, and cause the children of Israel to sin, and to be banished from the good land into another that is not ours, as we have been exiled through his being a bondservant in Egypt. Further, I will... Okay, so all that stuff is mostly not in the Greek that I read. A few parts are similar, but most of it's completely different. He says, Further, I will tell you the vision I saw when I was pasturing the flock. I saw, and lo, my 12 brothers were pasturing with me in the field. And lo, our father came and said to us, My children, run and seize ye each before me what comes to his portion. We answered and said unto him, What shall we seize? Lo, we see nothing but the sun, moon, and the stars. He said unto them, Take hold of them. When Levi heard it, he seized the staff in his hand, and jumped upon the sun, and sat and rode thereon. And when Judah saw it, he did likewise, and he seized the staff, and sprang upon the moon, and rode thereon. So did all the tribes, each rode upon his star, and his planet in the heavens. And Joseph only remained alone upon the earth. Jacob our father said unto him, My son, why hast thou not done as thy brothers? He said unto him, My father, what have they that are born of woman to do in the heavens, as in the end they must needs stand upon the earth? While Joseph was speaking, lo, there stood near him a huge bull with great wings like the wings of a stork, and his horns were huge like the horns of the reem. Reem is a rabbinic word, which is most likely was not in this, in the original. And Jacob said to him, Get up, my son Joseph, and ride upon him. And Joseph got up and mounted upon the bull. And Jacob our father departed from us. For about 4 hours Joseph gloried in the bull. At times he walked and ran, and at times he flew up with him, till he came near to Judah. And Joseph stretched out the standard he had in his hands, and began to smite Judah his brother. Judah said to him, My brother, why dost thou smite me? He said unto him, Because thou holdest in thy hands 12 staves, and I have only one. Give me 10, and there shall be peace. But Judah refused to give them to him, and Joseph beat him till he had taken from him 10 against his will, and only 2 were left with Judah. Joseph then said to his 10 brothers, Wherefore run ye after Judah and Levi? Depart from them and follow after me. When his brothers heard Joseph's words, they departed from Levi and Judah as one man to follow Joseph, and there remained with Judah only Benjamin and Levi. When Levi beheld this, he descended from the sun full of trouble and spirit. Joseph said to Benjamin his brother, Benjamin, my brother, art thou not my brother? Come thou also with me. But Benjamin refused to go with Joseph his brother. And it came to pass, when the day drew to an end, lo, there arose a mighty storm which separated Joseph from his brothers, so that no two were left together. When I beheld this vision, I related it to Jacob my father, and he said unto me, My son, it is only a dream which will neither ascend nor descend, for it had not been repeated. So I'll stop there for a second. That's the first dream, and it's a much longer version. When you compare it to what I read in the Greek, it's significantly longer, more detailed. Now here's the second dream he had. He says, But no long time elapsed when I saw another vision. Whilst we stood all together with Jacob, our father, on the shore of the great sea, behold, a ship came sailing in the middle of the sea, without a sailor and a man. Our father said to us, Do ye see what I am seeing? We said unto him, We see it. He said unto us, Do what ye see me doing. Thereupon Jacob, our father, took off his clothes and threw himself into the sea, and we all followed him. And the first were Levi and Judah, and they jumped in, and Jacob with them. And behold, in the ship there was all the goodness of the world. Jacob, our father, said unto them, Look at what is written on the mast, for there is no ship on which the name of the master is not written on the mast. Then Levi and Judah looked and saw, and behold, there was written, The ship belongs to the son of Barachel, and all the good therein. When Jacob, our father, heard that, he rejoiced very much and bowed down and thanked God. He said, not enough that he has blessed me on earth. He has blessed me on the sea, too. Then he said unto us, my children, quit yourselves like men, and whatever each one of you seizes, that shall be his share. Thereupon Levi sprang to the big mast therein and sat upon it. The second after him, Judah, also leapt to the second mast, which was next to Levi's mast, and he also sat thereon. And the rest of my other brothers took each his oar, and Jacob our father grasped the two udders to steer the ship by them. And Joseph was left alone. Our father said unto him, my son Joseph, take thou also thine oar. But Joseph refused. When my father saw that Joseph refused to take his oar, he said unto him, come here, my son, and take one of the rudders which I hold in my hands, and steer the ship, whilst thy brothers row with the oars until you reach land. And he taught each one of us, and said unto us, thus ye shall steer the ship, and ye will not be afraid of the waves of the sea, nor of stormy winds when they shall arise against you. And when he had made an end of commanding us, he disappeared from us. And Joseph took both the rudders, one of the right hand and one of the left, and the rest of my brothers were rowing, and the ship sailed on and floated over the waters. And Levi and Judah sat upon the two masts to look out which way the ship was to take. As long as Joseph and Judah were of one mind, and Judah showed to Joseph which was the right way, Joseph directed thither the ship. And the ship sailed on peaceably without hindrance. And after a while, quarrel arose between Joseph and Judah, and Joseph no longer steered the ship according to the words of his father and the teaching of Judah. And the ship went a wrong course, and the waves of the sea dashed it on a rock, so that the ship was broken up. Then Levi and Judah descended from the mast to escape for their lives, and as for the rest of the brothers, we escaped for our lives to the shore. And behold, there came Jacob our father, and found us dispersed, one here and another there. He said unto us, what is the matter with you, my sons? Perhaps you have not steered the ship as it ought, as I commanded you. And we said unto him, by the life of thy servants, we have not departed from anything that thou hast commanded us. But Joseph transgressed against the command, for he did not steer the ship according to thy command, and as he was instructed by Levi and Judah, for he was jealous of them. And he said unto us, show me the place. And he saw, and behold, the tops of the mast were visible, and behold, it was floating upon the surface of the water. And my father whistled, and we all gathered round him. And he cast himself in the sea as before, and he repaired the ship. And he reproved Joseph, and said unto him, my son, thou shalt not again deceive, nor be jealous of thy brothers, for they were nearly lost through thee. And when I recounted this vision to my father, he smote his hands together and sighed, and his eyes shed tears. And I waited till I was ashamed, but he spoke no word to me. So I took the hand of my father to embrace it and to kiss it, and I said to him, O servant of the Lord, why do thine eyes shed tears? He said unto me, my son, because of the repetition of thy vision, my heart has sunk within me, and my body is confounded by reason of Joseph, my son, for I loved him above you all. And for the wickedness of my son Joseph, you will be sent into captivity, and you will be scattered among the nations. For thy first and second visions are both one and the same vision. Therefore I command you not to unite with the sons of Joseph, but only with Levi and Judah. So I'll stop there for a second. That's a much longer version, as you can see. And there's some differences. I believe the differences are because the rabbinic version did not preserve the whole text. I believe the Greek version is valid, what it says, and that this Hebrew version, the longer one, is valid too. But like the Greek version, they removed some of it, and the Hebrew version must have removed some of it too. Because in the Greek, Jacob says about how Joseph is still alive, and he's really happy about it. Here we see like Jacob is like completely upset, and nothing about Joseph. We see in the Testaments that Joseph is always praised by the patriarchs, but in this Hebrew one, of Naphtali, Joseph is constantly criticized throughout it. So some scholars believe that this is not the original because it is so critical of Joseph. But I believe that's not correct, and I think we have to see the scripture of prophecy in that Joseph is the one, you know, the house of Joseph. It is his fault. Not Joseph the man, but his tribe would cause the 10 tribes of Israel to fall astray. So I think the original version of the Testament of Naphtali was a mixture of the two. That longer version, but it also had the positive stuff from the Greek that the rabbinic version decided to remove that positive stuff for some reason. So let's see here. I won't say much more of this, but basically there's a little bit more in the longer version, but some of the stuff that he says sounds a lot like rabbinic stuff, so I'm wondering if perhaps the rabbis might have added a couple things not part of the original. But otherwise, I think the whole thing is the Hebrew Testament of Naphtali is preserving the fuller version of Naphtali's Testament. So let's see here. I'm skipping two paragraphs of text, and I'm going to the last paragraph. So I'll read the last paragraph. It says, "Then the Most High dispersed the nations." Then the Most High dispersed the nations and apportioned and allotted to every nation its share and lot. And from that time, all the nations of the earth separated themselves from the Lord. Blessed be He. Only the house of Abraham remained with his Creator to worship Him, and after him Isaac and Jacob. Therefore, my sons, I conjure you not to go astray and worship any other god than him whom your fathers have chosen. For know assuredly that there is none like unto him, and no other who can do as he or like his works in heaven and on earth, and there is none who can do wonders like unto his mighty deeds. A portion only of his power you can see in the creation of man. How many notable wonders are there not in him? He created him from head to foot. With his ears he hears, and with his eyes he sees, and with his brain he understands, and with his nose he smells, and with his windpipe he brings forth his voice, and with his gullet he absorbs food and drink, and with his tongue he speaks, and with his mouth he completes. With his hands he does his work, and with his heart he reckons, and with his spleen he laughs, and with his liver he is angry, and his maw grinds, and with his feet he walks, and his lungs are for breathing, and by his reins he is counseled. And none of his members changes its functions, but everyone keeps to its own. It is therefore proper for man to lay to heart all these things. Who hath created him, and who is it that hath wrought him out of an ill-smelling drop of the womb of the woman? And who is it that bringeth him out into the light of the world? And who hath given him the sight of the eyes and the walking of the feet? And who causeth him to stand upright and blesses him nigh to his Creator and to his place? And hath prepared good deeds for him in the place of insight, and hath poured into him a living soul and a pure spirit from himself. Blessed is the man who does not defile the Holy Spirit of God, which hath been put and breathed into him, and blessed is he who returns it to its Creator as pure as it was on the day when he entrusted it." And that's all I'll read from that longer version. The rabbis, I think they added a little thing. They said, "Thus far the words of Naphtali, the son of Israel, which he admonished his sons with words sweeter than honey." So basically, we see the evidence of the two testaments, a much longer version. So it's very amazing that how much has been lost from the testaments, but what we do have is very beautiful and inspiring. Now, we've already gone to 2.5 hours. I'll do one final thing and we'll close. It's pretty brief. I mentioned in the Dead Sea Scrolls was found fragments of the Testament of Naphtali. So tiny fragments. I'm going to read that because I trust the Dead Sea Scrolls more than this long version that the rabbis preserved. I don't trust the rabbis as much. So again, there's like almost nothing that preserved, so this won't take long at all. Let me just open that now. Just opening the PDF file, it should take less than 20 seconds. Okay, loading it now. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this teaching. It was long, but it's very in-depth and powerful information, so I really hope it blessed you. So let me conclude this. Naphtali. It's around 2:14. There we go, 2:15. So, here's the fragments. Okay, yeah. That's... Sorry to hear that, Sean, about the last thing that I said. The last 30 minutes being not good for your internet wasn't good, so... And you missed a couple parts in the beginning, though, so you can listen to it again and give you more time to ponder on it, meditate on things I say. You can pause it and think about it and stuff. But so here's what this they found in the Dead Sea Scrolls 3 fragments, and what they do is they look at the fragments and see, oh look, this fragment looks like it fits with this one because they're so similar. And like, imagine if you have a paper and you rip it in half, but it's not a perfect right down the middle, it's like a diagonal. Well, you can see, oh look, it fits together. That's kind of what they do a lot with the Dead Sea Scrolls. Sometimes that's kind of iffy because they can make things fit that should never have fit because they were not part of it, but they can be creative sometimes and that's not good. So you always have to be aware when they do that. So in this example, they took three different fragments and put them together as one fragment. And so this is what they have it as. They say, with Ahiot, Bilhah's father, my mother and her aunt was Deborah, who suckled Rebekah. And then a little bit later, and he went to captivity, but Laban went and freed him, and he gave Hannah to him, one of his maidservants, and she conceived and gave birth first to Zilpah. He gave her the name of Zilpah, the name of the city in which he had been prisoner. And then it goes a little bit later, and she conceived and gave birth to Bilhah, my mother. Hannah gave her the name of Bilhah, for when she was born, there's a little bit missing, and it says, hurried to suck. And she said, how my daughter hurries. And she called her Bilhah again. And then there's some text missing. And then, when Jacob my father came to Laban, fleeing away from his brother Esau, and when the father of Bilhah my mother, and Laban led Hannah my mother's mother, and her two daughters with him, and he gave one to Leah, and the other to Rachel. And as Rachel did not bear sons, Jacob my father, and he was given Bilhah my mother, and she bore Dan my brother. And then it breaks off there. So we see that in the original testament of Naphtali, there was more information about his family, but that rabbinic version had nothing about his family. So we already see that the rabbinic version did not preserve the full text. It just preserved the most important part of it, is the fuller version of the two visions that he had. And then there's one other fragment that I'm going to read. Scholars originally said this is part of the Testament of Naphtali, and now a lot of scholars say it's not. But I'm still inclined to think that it is a fragment of the Testament of Naphtali. And this is an extra prophecy which has no correspondence with what we have. And so it says, in the dread of hardship, in the trial of a pit, and they will refine by them the chosen of justice, and he will wipe out all iniquity on account of his pious ones. For the age of wickedness is fulfilled, and all just injustice will pass away. For the time of justice has arrived, and the earth is filled with knowledge and the praise of God. In the days, the age of peace has arrived, and the laws of truth, and the testimony of justice, to instruct all in God's paths, and in the mighty acts of his deeds, for eternal ages. Every tongue will bless him, and every man will bow down before him, and they will be of one mind. For he knows their actions before they were created, and the service of justice he has divided their territories in their generations. For the dominion of justice of goodness has arrived, and he will raise the throne of, and very high. Intelligence, prudence, and sound wisdom are tested by his holy design. There's a couple other fragments, but that's pretty much the main essence of it. So anyways, that's the Testament of Naphtali. Not as powerful as what we have for the Testament of Levi, but still a very amazing preservation of this testament. Now there's one final question. when the scriptures give reference to Jasher, what do I think it's referring to? Is there more than one version of Jasher? Well, there's no reference in Jasher in the Dead Sea Scrolls, first of all. There's no reference of Jasher in Joshua in the Septuagint version. There is a reference to Jasher in the Septuagint version of 2 Samuel. I'm inclined to think that there was no original Jasher, that the rabbis added to it, that added that reference as like a commentary. They added it in. But if there was an original Jasher, I think it's now either lost, or maybe it's the Book of Jubilees or some other book that's lost. I don't think the current Book of Jasher that is so popular with people is valid at all. The reason is it's so contrary to the Dead Sea Scrolls, and it reads more like a fairy tale. It's not very believable. And there's so many contradictions, even with the New Testament. And even some things it says don't really jive with the plain sense of the Torah itself. Like, it says some really silly things in it. So if you really study through it and compare what you see with the Dead Sea Scrolls, with the Torah itself, you'll see it doesn't pass the test of the Spirit, I don't think, the current Jasher that's being used. So I would try to avoid Jasher, but if you want to be fair to it, you can try to read it yourself. But let me tell you what I did. I went through Jasher in depth once and took Jubilees, compared them, and they contradicted each other on almost every page, majorly. So basically, like, how could they so blatantly contradict? It's really crazy. Yeah, you have to look at the whole to see if it fits. And I've looked through all of Jasher, and it's just, it doesn't fit. Like, I've seen so many people that accept both Jasher and Jubilees, and I shake my head and say, I can't believe they are saying they accept both. I used to be guilty of that, but I had never studied in depth like it before. But once you study in depth, you can see you cannot accept Jasher and Jubilees at the same time. You have to pick one or the other. It can't be both, because you could not write two books that disagree more with each other than Jubilees and Jasher, if you sit down and look at all the differences. The reference in Joshua, that is not found. That passage is not found, so we can't know for certain there. And I don't think it's in 2 Samuel either. There was no fragment preserving that verse in either of those cases. So we can't know for certain what the Dead Sea Scrolls says. I would say if the Dead Sea Scrolls mentions Jasher, then there probably was a Jasher. If it didn't, and we don't know, we just have to speculate. If the Dead Sea Scrolls did not mention it, I don't think there was Jasher. But I've speculated the possibility of Book of Jubilees being Jasher, because Book of Jubilees says something very similar to 2 Samuel, description of Jasher. And I don't think the Joshua reference to Jasher is original. It's not in the Septuagint. And I think the Septuagint is correct in this instance, and that reference to Jasher was never there. I think, in general, the Septuagint version is the more accurate than the Masoretic text, but not always. There are some exceptions. But in this case, I think Joshua's Septuagint version is more correct in not including the reference to Jasher. When I first started out seeking the truth, I accepted Jasher because I was like, look, it says Jasher, so it has to be scripture, because the Bible says it's Jasher. It appeals to it as authority. But over the years, I realized that appeal to Jasher has been added, since there's actual evidence that's been added by the Septuagint Joshua. We see it's not in there. So that's an indication that might have been added. I try to not reject a passage reading unless there's manuscript evidence or scriptural evidence that it had to be added. I try not to be too quick to throw out a reading, but I think there's reason to believe that the reference to Jasher, at least in Joshua, was added and should not be there. So hopefully that answers the question. Yeah, I think it was rabbinic manipulation. So thank you guys for sitting through this all. It was very long, in-depth, but I appreciate you sitting through it all. And can you guys make it Sunday? If you do, we will be doing at least the next two Testaments. That's the Testament of Judah and Testament of Joseph. And it won't take as long because they are They don't have Dead Sea Scrolls. They don't have a longer version, so it'll be quicker. And the time is going to be the same time as tonight. It'll be 9, and then I'll start at 9:15. And I'll try to keep it 2 hours or less. I'm not going to try to go over 2 hours this time. In our next one. In Eastern time zone. All right, guys. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. It really encourages me. And I just want to say, I'm not going to name names, but people have been supporting my ministry in recent times, donating, helping me get books and resources. This is really helping me in my work, because the more resources I get from like the Dead Sea Scrolls, it will really help restore the scriptures. I'm making a version of the Bible. It's a long project, but the more you guys can help with this, the more amazing fruit we can have in this. Anyways, thank you. Thank you, Ben, for attending. Shalom. You guys have a great weekend, a great Sabbath. Shabbat shalom to you tomorrow. And don't be too crazy about the Christmas stuff. Don't worry, you know. All right, peace. Bye.